Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and the world. Welcome to the C Morning Show, everybody. It's Sunday, March the 31st, the last day of the month. We're about 2 weeks away from Eid, and it's always a great pleasure to bring you your morning news because we have top stories from Indonesia and around the world within the next 3 hours. I'm Satya Permesi, and of course, I'm not alone here. I am with my colleagues, Shafira and Indra Marpaung. Good morning, guys. How are
good
you doing?
Good morning, gentlemen.
Happy Sunday.
Happy
Sunday. Yes. It is Easter. Happy Easter, everybody.
How is your Easter,
yes.
Indra? How's you
I'm at
going
work.
Out somewhere? Oh my God!
How good?
Good example, of course.
Yes.
And since this is the last day of March, hope you guys are having a good time today. And it's still weekend. Hope you guys are having a good time with the family as well. Good morning, everyone. My name is Shafira, and in addition to what Messi just said, we'll also have special talk show later on. Make sure you stay tuned for that. You can always connect with us on social media at C3 News on Instagram, X, also YouTube.
Yes, I'm your host, Indra Marpaung. Would like to greet our viewers that are now able to tune in from Foxtel Flash Australia, Macau Cable TV Channel 84, Vision Philippines Channel 58, Air Cable Philippines, and Singtel Singapore Channel 15, and of course on StarHub Channel 720. Let's start the show with our headlines.
Mourners gathered for the funeral of a 13-year-old Palestinian boy in the West Bank city of Kabatia on Saturday after he was reportedly killed in an Israeli military raid.
Three United Nations military observers and a Lebanese interpreter were wounded Saturday while patrolling the southern Lebanese border after a shell exploded near them.
A regional military command ammunition warehouse at Tiang Saf village in Bogor, West Java, which borders Bekasi, exploded.
And later on during the show, Juicy Lucy, a band from Bandung, will perform their new single, Ha Ha Ha. Usually on Sunday, we would have our beginning of the show on the sofa, but of course, obviously, today has been quite a busy day, and yesterday has been quite a busy Saturday as well, with a lot of news. Beginning with a regional military command's ammunition warehouse at the Ciangsana village in Bogor, West Java, which borders Bekasi, exploded at 6:30 p.m. on Saturday. The sounds of explosions were still heard by locals well into the night.
The sounds of explosions were heard in surrounding residential areas since the 6:30 p.m. This follows an explosion at a regional military command's ammunition warehouse in Ciangsana village, Bogor Regency, West Java, which borders with Bekasi. Military Regional Commander Major General Muhammad Hassan said that there were no casualties in the incident. He added that the warehouse contained 160,000 types of explosives.
Gudang munisi nomor 6 itu berisi munisi-munisi yang sudah kadaluarsa dan pengembalian dari berbagai satuan yang dilayani oleh Kodam Jaya di seluruh wilayah Jakarta ini dan berkisar sekitar ada 160.000 jenis munisi maupun bahan peledak yang ada di gudang itu. Dan sampai dengan saat ini kami sudah mengecek seluruh lokasi di perimeter kita, satu pulau ke depan ke arah pemukiman, tidak ada korban jiwa. Itu kami tegaskan, tidak ada korban jiwa. Walaupun saat ini memang kami tidak bisa masuk langsung ke lokasi karena masih ada kerawanan ledak-ledak kecil. Tapi dapat kami pastikan bahwa sistem pengudangan di Kodam Jaya ini, di gudang ini, sudah sangat aman. Karena lokasinya berada di bunker dan di atasnya ada tanggul-tanggul yang mengamankan kalau ada ledakan ke samping, tapi kemudian kalau ke atas mungkin bisa menyebar sampai ke beberapa tempat. Tapi kami pastikan bahwa prosedur maupun sistem pengamanan di gudang ini sudah sedemikian rupa sehingga kalau ada ledakan seperti ini diperkirakan akan aman.
There were reports of ammunition and mechanized straying to residential areas prior to the blast. This prompted the regional military command to urge locals if they were affected by incident.
Walaupun mungkin tadi ada berita di media dan lain-lain, ada pelongsong yang sampai ke perumahan, itu memang ledakan yang mungkin horizontal, vertikal ke atas dan sampai di suatu tempat. dan kami sudah menghimbau warga-warga di sekitar wilayah yang sama ini 1-2 tahun ke depan ke wilayah-wilayah yang berpemukiman penduduk untuk mengecek apabila ada hal-hal yang mungkin terdampak dari ledakan.
Meanwhile, police lines were set up at Kota Wisata Residential Area in Cibubur, Bogor, which was affected by the blast. This follows the discovery of the mortar-like projectile, which locals suspected might have come from the blast at the ammunition warehouse. The object was found by locals not far from the scene of the explosion. It has since been secured by the military alongside several other objects. C2D contributor reporting from Bogor, West Java.
Acting West Java Governor Bey Mahmudin recently assessed the condition of those who sought shelter after an ammunition warehouse exploded in Bogor, West Java. They have been requested to remain at the shelter for their own safety.
Those who are seeking shelter following the ammunition warehouse blast is being temporarily housed at the home of the head of Tiangsana village in Gunung Putri Subdistrict Bogor Regency.
In addition, the acting governor has also coordinated with the Greater Jakarta Regional Military Commander to ensure that the explosion can be contained.
Tadi saya dari sisi sebelah sana sudah berkomunikasi dengan Pak Pangdam Jaya pertama untuk mengatasi di gudang itu. Pangdam Jaya sudah berkomunikasi dengan Pemprov DKI untuk mengirimkan armada pemadam kebakaran yang bisa menyemprotkan air dari jarak jauh. Dan kedua, kami sih di sini hanya untuk memastikan bahwa warga aman dan Pak Bupati sudah menerangkan warga dan di cluster ini sudah kosong bagi mereka memilih ke keluarga ini. Jadi tidak ke tempat yang disiapkan oleh Pak Bupati.
Jakarta Military Regional Command's ammunition warehouse in Bekasi exploded at 7:30 p.m. last night. According to the witnesses, the sound of explosion was still heard until last midnight, with hundreds of people have been evacuated to a safe haven. To know more on the updates, we have our team Adelia Dinda and Erwin Widiastama from the ground. Adele, how's the situation right now in Tiangsa, Bogor?
Yes, good morning, Indra. As we know that Jakarta Military Regional Command's ammunition warehouse exploded last night. And right now I'm standing within less than 1 kilometer radius of the warehouse as the area is restricted and we cannot enter it. And according to a statement from Jakarta Regional Military Commander Major General Muhammad Hassan, the smoke was seen for the first time from the warehouse number 6 at 6 p.m. last night, followed by the first explosion at 6:30 p.m. local time. And according to the witnesses around, the smoke has died down by midnight, but the sound of the explosion were still heard until last midnight, with the frequency decreasing at least to every once in 2 hours. And based on the data that I gathered on the ground, the last explosion was heard earlier at 1:30 a.m. And as of now, there are 27 fire engines from Bogor Regency, Bekasi, and Jakarta City passing through the area. And on our way here, we also saw several ambulances passing through the streets. Earlier, I also talked with one of the firefighters, and he said that the firefighters started to get into the warehouse at 12 last midnight, using robotic to extinguish the fire. And according to him, fortunately, there is no spread of the fire. And as of now, the firefighters are still performing the cooling phase for the next 2 hours. And as of now, we are seeing the fire engines who are getting out from the warehouse as the cooling phase is still performed for the next 2 hours until the condition is completely safe and sound inside the warehouse. This warehouse itself is located on the border of Bekasi and Bogor. The gate of the warehouse is located at Gunung Putri Bogor Regency, while some area of the warehouse is located at Bantar Gebang, Bekasi. And according to the military commander, the explosion was allegedly caused by a friction between chemicals contained in the expired ammunition. The suspicion also came from the fact that there is no electricity or any other system that caused the fire from outside of the warehouse. And for the record, there are an estimated 160,000 units of ammunition in the warehouse, with some of them aged more than 10 years old and are known to be expired. And previously, these expired ammunitions were on the process to be wiped out earlier this year. However, the process was still ongoing until the explosion occurred last night. And that being said, the military commander claimed that the warehouse has a safe and secure system since it was located in a bunker with several embankments located on top of it. And although there are no casualties, however, according to the witnesses, some ammunitions, including grenade and missiles, are scattered around the street, with some of it being discovered in people's houses. And not only that, but the explosion has also damaged people's houses, including broken glasses and collapsed ceilings. Until last midnight, people were prohibited from getting within a 1 kilometer radius of the warehouse. And meanwhile, the West Java acting governor, Bey Mahmudin, reported there are estimately 135 families who have been evacuated to prevent more serious damage from the explosion. And up until now, the Regional Disaster Management Agency are still checking on the total damage caused by the explosion. And that being said, the governor also ensured that the government will bear the cost of the damage to people's houses. And aside from that, the government has also prepared a soup kitchen for the evacuated to perform sahur earlier this morning. And that is all that I have for now, and we will keep gathering data from the ground regarding the further updates, especially for the people who have been evacuated to the shelter. Back to studio.
Adelia Dinda and Erwin Wiyastama, thank you very much for your report. Obviously, this is still an ongoing event, and we're looking forward to hearing more about the events as they unfold. Thank you very much for your report. Meanwhile, a residential area in East Cilandak, Pasar Minggu in South Jakarta was inundated after heavy rain soaked Jakarta on Saturday afternoon.
The water remained at around 40 to 60 centimeters high on Saturday night. This took place after heavy rain soaked Jakarta and rendered locals unable to perform their daily activities. Aside from heavy rain, the flood also caused the Krukut River, which is close to residential areas, to overflow.
Nonetheless, some residents choose to remain in their homes instead of seeking shelter, since they are convinced that the water will soon recede. Residential areas at Nis Road in East Cilandak, Pasar Minggu, South Jakarta, has always been prone to flooding.
Authorities have urged those who live near the river to remain vigilant of further potential floods, since heavy rain is still predicted to soak Jakarta and upstream areas, including Bogor.
We're up for our first short break, and after a break, we will still have more stories in Salam Ramadan.
Interesting and inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world.
Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan, every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you just stay tuned, because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories, only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Kebinjai. Mau migrasi?
Cakep!
Anjay, aku deport sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah! Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu, dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain!
Welcome to
Today Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
See Today Business.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat?
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim!
Simsalabim!
Abrakadabra!
Abrakadabra!
Singgobangkosir!
Singgobangkosir!
Pala botak gak bisa disisir!
Pala botak gak bisa.
Welcome back to the Sea Morning Show, everybody. And since we are in the holy month of Ramadan, let's take a look at some inspiring stories in the following Salam Ramadan special segment.
All right, our first story in Salam Ramadan special segment, less than 10 days ahead of Eid al-Fitri, the number of ship passengers in Ternate, North Maluku is starting to experience a surge.
They chose to return home earlier because they are worried of not getting Pelni ship tickets for their homecoming trip.
On Friday evening, Ahmad Yani Port in Ternate was teeming with homecoming travelers from 10 regencies in North Maluku province. These passengers had to deal with the crowded waiting area to get into their ship.
They are traveling on the Dorolonda ship to Ambon, Bau Bau, Makassar, Surabaya, and Jakarta, which carries up to 2,600 passengers. The Ternate office of the national shipping company, Pelni, said that there is a surge in passengers' number, but it is still within the ship's capacity.
Untuk penumpang yang mayoritas daripada mudik ini itu kebanyakan itu ke tujuan Ambon dan Bau-Bau, tapi yang lebih banyak itu tujuan ke Ambon, mayoritas itu tujuan ke Ambon, sehingga kapasitas penumpang ini masih sesuai dengan kapasitas yang ada dan dispensasi masih sesuai. Sebenarnya setiap tahun itu ada terjadi lonjakan, cuma karena ini kita kapal yang melayani itu ada backup dari KMS di Sinabung, sehingga tidak tertumpu ke satu kapal.
Airport Management Company PT Angkasa Pura 1 predicted a 7% rise in passengers going through Sultan Hasanuddin International Airport during the Eid holiday compared to last year. It is expected that there will be up to 530,000 passengers for Eid homecoming this year.
According to them, the most favorite route is from Makassar to Jakarta, followed by Makassar to Surabaya and Makassar to Kendari. The passengers are urged to get to the Sultan Hasanuddin International Airport early to avoid overcrowding.
And in our special segment, we also have a chance to see how people celebrate the holy month in other countries. And right now, we're connected with an Indonesian who lives in Australia, Nugroho Sunny. Good morning, Sunny.
Morning.
Hi, you live in Australia. Which part of Australia from the background? I can tell that you live in Sydney, right?
Yeah, currently I'm in Sydney right now, but I live in the Gold Coast, Queensland.
Oh.
Yeah, I just have like short vacation here in the Sydney.
All right. So what time is it now in Sydney? 4 hours ahead, right?
It's 4 hours ahead from Indonesia, yeah. So it's 10:20, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, and Sunny, how long have you lived in Australia for so far?
Less than one year, actually. I just arrived here in the early of the year, in the January.
Okay.
So it's been like 3 months here in Australia.
Right. Now you've experienced, 3 months in Australia and I assume a lot of years in Indonesia as well. Can you tell us a little bit about what you think separates Ramadan customs in Australia from that of Indonesia? How challenging is it to adjust to Ramadan there, especially you're there and you're fasting and it's only your third month in the country?
Yeah, it is. It's totally different experience here in Australia. Like usually in Indonesia, we are having behavior like getting to before having breakfasting. And it's quite hard to find like food stall here in Australia after 5 p.m. in the afternoon. So usually I cook by myself. I cook fritters, dessert, sweets, and also the working hour adjustment is not applicable here in Australia. Also the weather issues, especially in the summer, it's very hot. It's even more hotter here than in Indonesia in my experience. And also because I barely heard about the azan here because there's it's very quite far from my accommodation to the mosque, so I didn't hear any azan. So I'm stick to the application to know what the sahur time, to know the maghrib time for the breakfasting. Yeah, it's totally different from Indonesia, but I've enjoyed it.
Hey Sunny, it's Indra here. So let's speak about food. What Indonesian delicacy can you find in Australia especially during Ramadan? I mean, you mentioned it's kind of hard to find it, but can you find any Indonesian food to fulfill, you've been there for quite a few months, so.
Yeah, it's actually quite easy to find Indonesian restaurant here. Like in the Queensland, in the Brisbane, we have like several restaurants, at least two restaurants that I know serve Indonesian dishes. In the Gold Coast, we have two other restaurants. And I believe that in Sydney, in the Melbourne, in the Victoria, I believe the Indonesia restaurant is much more various because there are a lot of Indonesia people that living here in the New South Wales and also the Victoria. So it's quite easy. And also actually in the Coles, in the Aldi's, in the Woolies, they also sell instant seasoning for the Indonesia dishes. And also they have a lot of various instant noodles as well. It's my favorite actually.
Yeah, it looks delicious from the pictures that we're seeing in the picture. Now we know that of course Australia is full of Indonesian students and there is quite a significant Indonesian student society in almost every city in Australia. Now do you guys have a unique distinct way of celebrating Ramadan with each other in Australia? And if you do, can you share perhaps some of your more memorable experiences with us? Now, I know you were here only about for 3 months now, but so far, has there been any events going on between everyone in the Indonesian society in PPI?
Yeah, it is, absolutely. Even in my university, we have like Indonesia Student Association of Griffith University, and we just held like two grand iftar together. And yeah, in here, we are known the terms of potluck. So it's like the event with the food together and we're just sharing what we cook at the particular moment. And yeah, it's really, really relieving my homesickness of my Indonesian foods. And yeah, the people were very nice. And yeah, we just like supporting each other because living abroad is not easy. So that's why we need each other to support.
Okay, Sunny, you mentioned that you live in a few months now in Australia, less than a year. Do you feel like missing home sometimes, especially during Ramadan? And how do you deal with homesickness while living in Australia, especially in this very, very special month that usually we are having Ramadan together with the family, now you're away from them. How do you deal with that?
Yeah, it is an issue for me. as I mentioned before, we have a lot of supportive friends here. And I believe that in the Australia University, mental health really being a concern. So the university provides like mental counseling when we feel like homesickness. Mm. It's a very common condition, I believe, for the international student. And also, we are here in 2024. We have like sort of technology, so it's really easy to contact, to get in touch with our family, with our friends, through video call, by sharing pictures from social media. It's really, really helpful for me. Like I mentioned before, the mental health counseling is provided by the university through the student support, and it's totally free for us, especially for the Indonesia students. It's very helpful.
Nice, that's amazing. Can, you know, can help you to deal with the homesickness probably during the Ramadan and Eid al-Fitri, inshallah. Alrighty, thank you so much, Sunny. Thank you for your update.
Thank you.
You know, having a Ramadan in Australia as a newbie who lives in Australia. Hang in there, all right? Thank you so much. Thanks. And enjoy your sunny day in Australia, Sunny. Bye.
Yeah, sunny in Sydney.
Bye-bye. So after a quick break, we'll have Messi set to bring you some sports updates. Messi, what do you have for us today?
That was very punny of you, I have to say. All right, we have some updates from the Premier League, the Miami Open, and of course from the NBA. All that and more to come when we return on the CNN Morning Show. Your sports updates coming up next.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Indonesian Foreign Affairs Minister Retno Marsudi addressed the UN Security Council during an open debate in New York.
Ini adalah open debate Dewan Keamanan PBB ketiga mengenai Gaza dalam 3 bulan terakhir dan Indonesia hadir di ketiganya.
Kenapa sih dia selalu mau eksis kalau aku syuting? Ijo sama yang merah ini tuh rumah pribumi. Jadi aku taruh di dalam, makanya rasanya lebih welcome gitu. Modern banget. Sempit banget kalau ceilingnya pendek. Menurut aku ya, kita belum ngerasa memiliki kalau belum ada sejarahnya.
Figur publik kok kere. Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Orang setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat?
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim!
Simsalabim!
Abrakadabra!
Abrakadabra!
Singgobangkosir!
Singgobangkosir!
Pala botak gak bisa disisir!
Pala botak gak bisa.
Their existence is now being critically endangered.
Dia memiliki ekor yang sangat panjang, lebih panjang, jauh lebih panjang daripada badannya sendiri.
Tekniknya dia keluar, dia itu bergelombol menggunakan punggung temannya untuk naik.
Sebenarnya konservasi burung hantu di sini latar belakangnya jelas asas manfaat. Jadi kita pengen melestarikan burung, melestarikan satwa, tapi juga otomatis dampaknya ke masyarakat yang khususnya sekarang kalau di sini kan petani.
Binjai mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay aku deport sih.
Ya aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah. Kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia nggak sebaik itu, nggak sebagus itu, nggak seganteng itu, tapi itu hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain.
Welcome back to the C Morning Show. It's time for our first sports segment of the morning, beginning with the WNBA, where Brittany Griner has returned to Phoenix Mercury, which is the only WNBA team she has ever played for. The league announced her signing on X, formerly known as Twitter, on Friday night. Phoenix selected Griner at the number one overall pick in the 2013 WNBA draft following a stellar collegiate career at Baylor. The 6'8" center averages 17.7 points, 7.5 rebounds, and 2.7 blocks per game. She averaged 17.5 points and 6.3 rebounds per game last season after she was absent in 2022 as she was detained in Russia. She has returned to the U.S. as part of a high-profile prisoner swap. She helped lead Phoenix Mercury to win the 2014 WNBA championship after winning two gold medals in the Olympics. She is also a 9-time All-Star, 8-time blocks leader, 2-time Defensive Player of the Year, and 3-time All-League First Team member. Meanwhile, the NBA Dante Exum hit the winning three-pointer with 27.5 seconds to go. And the Dallas Mavericks, I apologize, Kyrie Irving had 30 points and the Dallas Mavericks beat the Sacramento Kings 107-103 on Friday night for their sixth straight win. Dallas, which has won 10 of its last 11 games, moves two games ahead of the Kings for the sixth spot in the Western Conference that would avoid the play-in tournament. Sacramento remains in the eighth spot in the West. Exum's wide-open shot set up by P.J. Washington made it 106-103 and capped the second-half comeback for the Mavericks. 14 of Irving's 30 points came in the fourth quarter, and Luka Doncic added 26 for Dallas. Harrison Barnes missed a potential game-tying three-point attempt and then committed a backcourt violation after the Kings got the offensive rebound.
A two for one. They trap him at midcourt. Washington. Exum missed earlier. That one is nothing but...
From big balls to small balls and from baskets to rackets, Grigor Dimitrov followed his ruthless upset of Carlos Alcaraz with another brilliant display to beat Alexander Zverev at the Miami Open semifinals. With a 6-4, 6-7, 6-4 victory, the Bulgarian advanced to his third ATP Masters 1000 and his first in Miami. The result also moved Dimitrov up to number 9 in the ATP rankings, securing his return to the top 10 for the first time since 2018. Meanwhile, Jannik Sinner awaits in Sunday's final after his 6-1, 6-2 victory against Medvedev on Friday. All right, that story wraps up our first sports segment of the morning. We're going to take another short break, but after the break, Shafira and Indra will be back with entertainment updates. Stay tuned.
China has been racing against time for rescue and disaster relief work after a landslide on Monday struck a mountainous village in southwest China's Yunnan province.
Kenapa sih dia selalu mau eksis kalau aku syuting? Ijo sama yang merah ini tuh rumah pribumi. Jadi aku taruh di dalam, makanya rasanya lebih welcome gitu. Modern banget. Dia tuh sempit banget kalau ceilingnya pendek. Menurut aku ya, kita belum ngerasa memiliki kalau belum ada sejarahnya.
Inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world. Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you just stay tuned because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories Only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Kabinjay, mau
mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay, aku deport sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi itu hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
My personal favorite segment. We're going to talk about entertainment updates.
I feel like you should just do it by yourself.
No. We need more information from you.
Will do.
All right. The first and foremost. Now let's talk about Queen Bey as she finally dropped her most awaited album, Cowboy Carter. It marks her 8th studio album in her illustrious music career.
After weeks of waiting with bated breath, Beyoncé's new album has finally arrived. The Houston-born superstar's 8th album is billed as the multi-genre nod to American country culture. It came with a chorus of praise from traditional country and country crossover artists, including several features on the album.
The album is filled with guest appearances from Dolly Parton to Post Malone, Miley Cyrus, among others. Prior to the official album drop, Beyoncé confirmed that the project would include a cover of Parton's Jolene, and the 78-year-old music icon quickly put her stamp of approval on it. The Cowboy Carter consists of 27 tracks, and it's available on all digital music platforms. All right. Okay, let's talk about that clip.
Where should we start?
It's a distraction.
So, yes. So one of the very interesting that I've been waiting for was actually Dolly Parton's actually. Mm. Well, she didn't really sing with Beyoncé. I just listened to it this morning. And then her rendition of Beyond, the Queen Bee rendition of Jolene, which is quite interesting. You know what's kind of funny? Like, remember how the story of like Taylor Swift coming out from country
to pop?
And then we have this pop queen coming into the country music. And then I listened to a little bit of her duet with Miley Cyrus.
Okay.
That was actually nice. Interesting.
Oh my God. How can she like doing the crossover?
That's right.
Musicians like Dolly Parton, Miley Cyrus, but
Post Malone,
yes. You know, another genre. But she is still become the queen.
Yes. And then,
oh my God.
And then she been doing her concert, right?
Exactly. The first leg.
So there's a second leg coming.
Hopefully, fingers. I really, one of my bucket lists to see is Beyonce, even though she's coming here one time, I think, around 2005 or 2006, I don't remember. But this time, I think it's gonna be different. She is going to bring a Renaissance album.
Yeah.
And now the Cowboy Carters.
Yeah.
It's more suitable to Asians market, hopefully. What do you think?
That'll be interesting though. Yeah, cause some country songs to on the second leg. That would be. So you know, if some minister or you know some promoters wanna bring her in to Indonesia.
We miss Taylor Swift. We miss Coldplay. Don't miss this one.
We did. We had Coldplay. One.
We had one. Oh, yeah. Only one. Don't miss this one. Please. If you want to do some effort, do this job.
Yes, I wanna listen to some Jolene live.
I want to see that as well. Ooh, kudos. All right, let's move on.
Moving on to Mahalini is finally back with the new music, with the release of her new single, Mati Matian, along with music video for the track.
After successfully holding a number of concerts in Indonesia and abroad, Balinese singer Mahalini Raharja is back with her latest work, Mati Matian, which she wrote with Anmesh Kamaleng. The pop ballad, which has a deep nuance wrapped in Mahalini's powerful voice, tells the story of someone who loves her partner so much and has made a lot of sacrifice, but her efforts turn out to be in vain. Mati Matian is now available on every digital music platform under Hits Record.
All right, still from the world of music, 2024 Grammy Award to Best African Music Performance winner, Tyla is now living her dream.
On a special interview, the 22-year-old singer has a huge vision on a pro pop. Let's check this out.
Starting from her hobby of covering songs on social media, Tyla transformed into a Grammy Award-winning singer in 2024. She made sure to put a snippet of South Africa as her hometown every time she creates a new song. And she dreams of making African music global one day. Tyla grew up in Johannesburg, South Africa, practicing acceptance speeches in the mirror, envisioning herself on the grandest award stages. But as she found out, a dream is one thing, reality is another.
Literally, like, I was practicing in the mirrors, like, perfect speeches, but literally on the way to the Grammys, I was like, hey, I did not write nothing, let me think of things in case I win. But I don't know, like, I was just moving, like, I was going with the flow that day. And I feel like God was just giving me peace and letting me know that, girl, you got it, like, relax. So that was kind of the energy of that day.
Throughout the past year, tons of good energy have been coming toward Tyla, who released her self-titled debut album last week. It is a culmination of lifelong aspirations for the 22-year-old, whose ambitions were always bigger than her continent, as massive as it is. Powered by the Cape Town recorded Water, a lightning-in-a-bottle smash that took the world by storm and earned her the Grammy before her album was released, she quickly became one of the leading faces popularizing music originating from Africa. As Afrobeats has gained massive attention the past few years, Tyla is introducing much of the world to Ampiano, which translates to the pianos in the Zulu language, a fusion of Kwaito house music and jazz often driven by locked drums. Tyla hopes fans gravitate to other songs like they did to Water. The album includes a remix version with Travis Scott, but admits she felt a bit of pressure. The song reached number 7 on the Billboard Hot 100 and trended on TikTok with her viral #WaterChallenge dance. While she doesn't know the specifics about a potential ban on the app in the US, she says it's slightly concerning.
It kind of does matter because TikTok really does help artists. It helps us reach places that we can't really reach. You know, like me being in South Africa, I was using TikTok and social media. I was using it heavy just to be seen, you know. So I do know the importance of the app. I don't know details about the bans and why it's getting banned and all, but I mean, I'm always going to be on TikTok.
Presently, Tyla is living in the moment, saying that she's happy with the response to the album and hopes to begin an international tour that was postponed due to an injury. Message received, oh, now you want me back, I know the procedure, trying to
piano right there.
Yeah, I believe so. Good job.
All right, from music, we go to film, where Tom Holland has concluded the hunt for his Juliet in the new production of Romeo and Juliet that he will star in on the West End.
The 27-year-old Spider-Man actor is set to play Romeo in the retelling of Shakespeare's iconic and tragic love story. He will be sharing the stage with newcomer Francesca Amewuda Rivers on opening night on May 23rd at the Duke of York's Theatre.
Amewuda Rivers previously appeared in the 2 seasons of the BBC series Bad Education and 3 short films. She also has some stage experience in a number of productions at the Globe and Hammersmith, among other venues.
After the announcement, Francesca stated that she was so grateful to be making her West End debut as Juliet with the Jamie Lloyd Company. All right, let's move on. Oscar winner Michelle Yeoh, Botswana President Mokwetsi Masisi, and Verizon CEO Hans Westbrook are among the diverse group of political, business, and philanthropic leaders. Global Citizen Now, a summit will take place as they convened in New York on May 1st and the 2nd, the nonprofit organization announced.
According to the Global Citizen CEO Hugh Evan, the Global Citizen Now Summit will seek support for workable solutions to address issues of food insecurity, climate change, and public health associated with extreme poverty.
Actors Hugh Jackman, Danai Gurira, and Dakota Johnson, along with representatives from Cisco, Citi, Delta, and PayPal, will join Rockefeller Foundation President Rajiv Shah, Bezos Earth Fund CEO Andrew Scheer, and Volker Turk, United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights, for the event.
Evans said the 3rd edition of Global Citizens Now will focus on defeating preventable diseases like malaria, polio, and HPV. Organizers also plan to announce new initiatives to preserve the Amazon rainforest and increase investment in Africa through the World Bank.
Global Citizen also hopes the New York Summit will build on momentum generated among Gen Z and millennial leaders at its first international conference earlier this month in Australia.
We'll have more interesting stories from around the world after the break, so stay here on the C Morning Show only on CTV.
Figur publik kok kere. Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business. Interesting and inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world. Our 3-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you just stay tuned because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories, only on
the 3-hour news show on See Today.
spicy.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Ke Binjai, mau migrasi.
Cakep!
Anjay, aku di Potsi.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh, ya Allah!
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi itu hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain!
Welcome back to the C Morning Show. It's time for some international news, beginning in the Middle East, where explosions could be heard and smoke was seen rising from the direction of Khan Yunis at the Muwasi refugee camp in Gaza.
This comes as Israel Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says Israel will return to the table for ceasefire talks with Hamas.
Friday's announcement marks yet another attempt to reach a deal to pause Israel's devastating war against Hamas in Gaza. Efforts by the United States, Qatar, and Egypt to negotiate a ceasefire appear stalled as the war grinds through its sixth month.
Israel's war in Gaza has killed more than 32,000 people and wounded 74,000, according to the territory's health ministry. The ministry doesn't differentiate between civilians and combatants in its tally, but says women and children make up two-thirds of the dead.
The UN has reported that 100% of Gaza's 2.3 million people are at severe levels of food insecurity. Aid deliveries have been impeded by Israeli military restrictions, ongoing hostilities, and the breakdown of the public order. Mourners gather for the funeral of a 13-year-old Palestinian boy in the West Bank city of Kabatia on Saturday after he was reportedly killed in an Israeli military raid.
According to the Palestinian news agency Wafa, the boy was shot and killed and two others were injured, one of them critically in Israeli operation early Saturday in Kabatia. Dr. Fawaz Hamad, the director of Al-Razi Hospital in Jenin, named the boy as Mutazim Nabil Abid via local station Auda TV. Since the war began, military raids and settler attacks have spiked in the West Bank. More than 400 Palestinians have been killed by Israeli forces or settlers in the West Bank or East Jerusalem.
Elsewhere, dozens of Muslims performed Friday prayers during the holy month of Ramadan in the open air close to a destroyed mosque in a refugee camp in the Gaza Strip.
This year, the holy month of Ramadan comes as the humanitarian catastrophe in Gaza continues. The Friday prayers remain solemn among the ruins of the mosque and buildings amid hunger worsening across Gaza due to the humanitarian and blockade.
Each of the men who performed the prayers brought their own rug as they prayed in the street at the Jabalia refugee camp.
According to the territory's health ministry, more than 32,000 people have been killed in Gaza, with women and children making up two-thirds of the dead and 74,000 wounded since the start of the catastrophe.
رغم الخسف والدمار الذي ارتكبه العدو بحق المساجد والبيوت والبشر والشجر إلا أننا نحافظ على الصلوات في هذه المصليات وبإذن الله تعالى سنؤدي هذه الشعائر ونحن في شهر رمضان وفي حرمة شهر رمضان رغم الألم ورغم ما تم من حصار وجوع وتضييق على أبناء شعبنا إلا أننا سنصر ونستمر في نهجنا وفي رضاء ربنا سبحانه وتعالى.
Meanwhile, Palestinians attended the third Friday prayers of the holy month of Ramadan at the Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem.
Muslims came to the revered mosque from all over the country amid tight security following fears the ongoing humanitarian catastrophe could spark clashes in Jerusalem's old city.
The prayers happened a day after the top United Nations court ordered Israel to take measures to improve the humanitarian situation in Gaza, including opening more land crossings to allow food, water, fuel, and other supplies into the war-ravaged enclave.
The International Court of Justice issued two new provisional measures in a case brought by South Africa, accusing Israel of acts of genocide in its military campaign. The country, however, denies it is committing genocide.
من هناك لهون تقريبا المسافة 80 كيلو تواجهنا بأكثر من يمكن ولا 10 حواجز على حاجز بيت لحم قعدنا ساعة وإحنا واقفين على الحاجز يعني فيش ولا واحد بيقدر يبرق اللي يكون ممغنط آخر النهار بدك تتوقع إنك أنت رجعت إذا وقع ما رجعت بيتلفنوا عليك على نفس التلفون اللي سويت منه المنسق مشان ترجع يضمنوا انك انت طلعت من القدس.
Meanwhile, three United Nations military observers and a Lebanese interpreter were wounded on Saturday while patrolling the southern Lebanese border after a shell exploded near them.
The military observers are part of the United Nations Truce Supervision Organization, which supports the UN peacekeeping mission in southern Lebanon, UNIFIL.
The blast came as clashes between the Israeli military and Hezbollah militants escalated in recent weeks. Both sides have been exchanging fire since the Israel-Hamas war in Gaza broke out, propelling concerns that the near-daily clashes along the border could escalate into a full-scale war.
Local Lebanese media, citing security officials, said an Israeli drone strike targeted the observers in the southern village of Wadi Katmun near the border town of Rimich.
Hezbollah-run television station Al-Manar said the drone strike wounded three officers from Australia, Chile, and Norway, as well as a Lebanese interpreter. Meanwhile, a spokesperson for the United Nations Interim Force in Lebanon, or UNIFIL, Andrea Tenenti, told the Associated Press that three UN Group Lebanon military observers and a language assistant were injured in southern Lebanon on Saturday. They have since been stabilized.
Tenenti announced that UNIFIL has launched an investigation to the incident after the four individuals were wounded by a shell while patrolling the southern Lebanese border.
She added that the UNIFIL had informed all warring parties of their patrols while vehicles transporting the observers had clear UN markings.
Three OGL observers, military observers, unarmed, were in the area together with their language assistants, and they were injured. Luckily, they are stable at the moment. So we have launched an investigation to look into this incident and into the explosions. I know that there are a lot of speculations at the moment, but in relation to what we do as an organization, we need to verify the information through our own investigation. So I hope we will be able to find out more shortly. We have been in touch with everyone, with both sides, and we've been in touch even when we're doing patrolling. We inform the parties that we are going to different locations. And UNIFIL, we are very visible. We have white vehicles with the UN written on it, big blue flags. So very difficult to think that we are somebody else. So we have been informing the parties, we are working with them, and we are coordinating also during this investigation.
In other news, top diplomats from Egypt, Jordan, and France met on Saturday in Cairo for talks.
Egypt's Foreign Minister Sameh Shoukry received French Foreign Minister Stéphane Séjourné and Jordanian Foreign Minister Ayman Safadi in the Egyptian capital.
During the meeting, the ministers discussed the Israel-Hamas war and Israel's looming offensive on the packed city of Rafah.
Israel has promised to launch an offensive of Rafah, saying the city on the border with Egypt is the last remaining Hamas stronghold in the Gaza Strip.
تم التطرق أيضا إلى خطورة إقدام إسرائيل على شن عملية عسكرية على مدينة رفح الفلسطينية والعواقب الوخيمة التي ستنتج عنها وتشاركنا مع الجانبين الفرنسي والأردني في التحذير من مغبة الإقدام على تلك العملية على ضوء اكتظاظ المدينة بأكثر من 1.5 مليون نازح.
ما الذي يحول دون توفير الطعام والغذاء والدواء للشعب الفلسطيني في غزة؟ هو قرار سياسي لحكومة متطرفة قررت أن تستخدم التجويع سلاحاً.
The surge in gang violence that has plagued Haiti this month has spread to part of the capital, Port-au-Prince, which houses some of the country's most prominent institutions.
Residents are concerned with surging violence and doubt the security of areas they thought were relatively safe.
Matiado Vilme has exclusive video from the streets of the Haitian capital in the following story, narrated by Michael Lippin.
Gunfire erupted in the streets surrounding a major public park in downtown Port-au-Prince, Haiti on March 21st. What is going on? Our reporter asked one of the many people running away from the shooting near the Champ de Mars. There was no answer, but another terrified woman could be heard saying, "Sweet Jesus, I am going to die today." One man, who didn't provide his name, was walking away from the violence when he noticed our reporter's Voice of America insignia. He stopped to share his experience.
There are a lot of rumors going around. I'm here to sell stuff, and I cannot even make a sale. I am now 60 years old. I cannot live under this kind of pressure. I have to leave and go home.
A young man on a motorcycle, bleeding from his leg, stopped to get his wound bandaged by an armed man dressed in black. Uniformed police patrolling the streets shouted for people to leave the area, as others guarded the entrance to a base of UDMO, a Haitian National Police unit responsible for crowd control. 5 days later, the aftermath of the gang violence was evident on Monseigneur Guillou Street, adjacent to the State University of Haiti Hospital. This was a medical clinic looted by members of a coalition of gangs who call themselves Vive Ensemble. The bandits looted and burned other businesses, including one where Jean-Yves Policar says he had been working for 37 years.
I don't know yet how much I've lost. Being so close to the hospital and the presidential palace, I didn't think that I would face this situation. When I saw everybody running for the hills, I said to myself, I'll keep my cool, because my proximity to those sites would give me some kind of safety. At the end of the day, the security was simply zero.
That absence of security has left residents of the Haitian capital wandering through the wreckage of burned-out cars and debris-filled streets, not knowing when the gang violence will end. For Matiado Vilme in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, Michael Lippin, VOA News.
And we'll take another break. When we come back, we'll have some local updates from around Southeast Asia. So stay tuned to the Sea Morning Show only on Sea Today. Bringing you the latest, interesting, and inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world.
Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you just stay tuned because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories, only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Kabinjay, mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay, aku di pot sih.
Aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah. Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain.
Welcome to to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on City Day Business.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga. Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Orang setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Indonesian Foreign Affairs Minister Retno Marsudi addressed the UN Security Council during an open debate in New York.
Ini adalah open debate Dewan Keamanan PBB ketiga mengenai Gaza dalam 3 bulan terakhir dan Indonesia hadir di ketiganya.
Kenapa sih dia selalu mau eksis kalau aku syuting? Ijo sama yang merah ini tuh rumah pribumi. Jadi aku taruh di dalam, makanya rasanya lebih welcome gitu. Modern banget. Sempit banget kalau ceilingnya pendek. Menurut aku ya, kita belum ngerasa memiliki kalau belum ada sejarahnya.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Orang setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak gak bisa.
Their existence is now being critically endangered.
Dia memiliki ekor yang sangat panjang, lebih panjang, jauh lebih panjang daripada badannya sendiri.
Tekniknya dia keluar, dia itu bergelombol menggunakan punggung temannya untuk naik.
Sebenarnya konservasi burung hantu di sini latar belakangnya jelas asas manfaat. Jadi kita pengen melestarikan burung, melestarikan satwa, tapi juga otomatis dampaknya ke masyarakat yang khususnya sekarang kalau di sini kan petani.
Welcome back to the C Morning Show, everybody. In this segment, we will bring you updates from around Southeast Asia. And without further ado, let's begin our C headlines. Indra.
Thank you, Satya. First up from Malaysia, where authorities have arrested 3 individuals suspected of supplying firearms to a 36-year-old man with an Israeli passport who was detained earlier this week. The man was arrested with a bag containing 6 handguns and 200 bullets. He arrived at the Kuala Lumpur International Airport from the United Arab Emirates on March 12th with what authorities believe to be a fake French passport. According to Police Inspector General Rasan Rudin Hussein, on Friday, the man turned over an Israeli passport upon questioning and ordered the weapons after arriving in Malaysia. He also paid for them with cryptocurrency, as Malaysia and Israel have no diplomatic ties with the Israeli The Israeli embassy in Singapore have yet to respond to an email requested of inquiry regarding this situation.
Next up, from Myanmar, where Army Chief Min Aung Hlaing claim that the youth are being tricked to supporting the resistance against the military as anti-coup forces gain unprecedented advances. The military regime has suffered major losses to an alliance of ethnic minority groups and anti-coup forces 3 years after seizing power in a coup. Min Aung Hlaing, who addressed thousands of troops who during the Myanmar Armed Forces Day said that he was disheartened by the youth who have been misled by what he dubbed false narrative propaganda through media sabotage. He further accused ethnic armed groups of jeopardizing the potential for union based on democratic values and federalism. He then claimed that the military is working to restore peace and stability while also underlining the need for uniting.
And finally, from Thailand, where a court has dropped terrorism charges against 67 individuals who led anti-government protests in 2008. The Bangkok Criminal Court ruled on Friday that the so-called Yellow Shirt protests, which opposed a government headed by allies of deposed Prime Minister Thaksin Shinawatra, are protected under the Constitution. This is because they conducted the protest peacefully and without weapons. The 67 defendants on Friday's case had been indicted on charges of rebellion and terrorism, which may land them the death penalty. Thousands of yellow shirts took control of the airports and left hundreds of thousands of tourists stranded as they demanded the resignation of then Prime Minister and Thaksin's brother-in-law, Somchai Wongsawat. The court has also dropped charges against 31 other protest leaders in January, but ordered some to pay a fine of 20,000 baht, or $550, for violating an emergency decree. And let's begin with our first story from Southeast Asia. When it comes to culture, Vietnam is a rich tapestry of traditions, art forms, and religion. However, the influence of certain religions significantly varies.
Islam is one of the least common religions in the nation, but it gained a unique Muslim community with their own set of principles.
I'm standing right here at the only mosque in Hanoi, the capital city of Vietnam. Just one and only mosque for the whole north region of the country. It shows how minor the Muslim community here in Hanoi. However, the operation, especially the regular operation of the mosque in the evening, can show how actively the Muslim community right here in the capital city are managing to remain the faith in consonance, in harmony with the Vietnamese traditions, despite a lot of differences.
The first and foremost common practice that Muslims in Hanoi follow strictly is the Holy Friday gathering. Every Friday, the mosque named An Noor at number 12 Hang Luk Street is always filled with the devotees from all over the capital and surrounding areas. Even though it is the only mosque in Hanoi and the northern region, its regular operation shows the key point of Muslims' community, small but mighty.
Mình chỉ ước chừng tầm số lượng mà tín đồ đến thánh đường để hành lễ vào mỗi ngày như thế này sẽ rơi vào tầm khoảng 200 tín đồ, kể cả nam lẫn nữ. Thì vào trưa thứ sáu sẽ có thêm một cái buổi thuyết giảng cho các tín đồ sẽ thay thế vào cái buổi hành lễ đó.
Mình có một lời mời đến để có thể tham quan và để tìm hiểu một chút về nét văn hóa của người Hồi giáo. Thì thật ra là trước khi đến thì mình thì cũng cảm thấy hơi sợ một chút. Trước giờ mình và cái nét văn hóa này không có một cái sự kết nối nào đấy quá gần gũi cả. Và khi mà mình đến đây thì thật sự là mình cảm thấy rất là ấm áp. Bởi vì là khi mà mình vừa bước chân vào đây thôi thì mọi người đã ngay lập tức kiểu hỏi mình là mình có muốn ăn gì không hay đồ ăn ở đây, thì mọi người bảo là mình cứ tự nhiên lên mà không có một cái cảm giác là mình là một người ngoại đạo. Và khi mà mình muốn vào tham quan bên trong thì ra đây là một điều rất là khó, nhưng mà họ vẫn cho phép mình vào và họ còn hướng dẫn mình là phải đeo những cái khăn này như thế nào, thì mình cảm thấy là đây là một cái trải nghiệm rất là độc đáo với mình.
Second, Muslims in Vietnam have to make adjustments in their lifestyle to deal with the Vietnamese laws. For example, Muslims cannot practice polygamy in Vietnam, or under Islamic law, a married woman who cheats on her husband can be stoned to death, which never happened in Vietnam. However, some cultural clashes seem unavoidable once a Vietnamese person converts to Islam. While it is very important for Vietnamese people to worship ancestors, Muslims are not allowed to do so. For a big Vietnamese family, it is understandable when members follow various religions. So nowadays, ancestor worship is not a big deal. To Muslims in Vietnam, Vietnam's drinking culture is sometimes a headache and requires lots of effort during gatherings.
Đã là một người Muslim, chắc chắn sẽ từ chối những cái điều đó. Quan trọng là mình sẽ lựa chọn những cái cách thức, những cái hình thức từ chối như thế nào cho nó thật tế nhị. Chứ không có cái chuyện gọi là uống bất chấp, uống để cho người khác vui lòng. Và nếu như họ có lỡ mời, thì mình sẽ trực tiếp nói với họ là mình là một tín đồ người Hồi giáo. Và cái việc rượu bia là một cái điều hoàn toàn bị cấm trong cái tôn giáo của mình. Và rất là mong mọi người thông cảm cho cái điều đấy.
Muslim strictly practicing principles and rituals makes Vietnamese understand that what Islamic principles aim to bring to the world goes around peace and happiness.
Câu chào cửa miệng của một tín đồ Muslim đối với một người Muslim khác, chào bình an và hòa bình đến với bạn. Hòa bình và bình an ở đây nó mang một cái ý nghĩa rất là đơn giản. Một khi mình thức dậy, mình được nhìn thấy mình trải qua một cái ngày trong cái sự hòa bình. Mình trải qua một cái ngày chỉ có trong đó sự tôn thờ, sự thờ phụng những việc làm, những việc làm tốt chẳng hạn. Đó chính là sự hòa bình, đó chính là sự bình an.
As the guide said, every Muslim prays for peace and blessing on a daily basis. That message is not only within the brotherhood of Islam worldwide, but also connect Muslims to the world. It goes beyond the consonance, the harmony between the spirit of Islam and Hanoi. It is the similarity. Because Hanoi, the capital city of Vietnam, is the city of peace. Tang Huyen Trang, reporting for C Today from Vietnam.
All right, guys, we're up for another short break. In the meantime, don't forget to follow our social media accounts if you haven't already. We're on Instagram, X, and YouTube, and our handle is at C Today News. Meanwhile, stay tuned on the C Morning Show.
Welcome to C Today Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
C Today Business.
Indonesian Foreign Affairs Minister Retno Marsudi addressed the UN Security Council during an open debate in New York.
Ini adalah open debate Dewan Keamanan PBB ketiga mengenai Gaza dalam tiga bulan terakhir dan Indonesia hadir di ketiganya.
Kenapa sih dia selalu mau eksis kalau aku syuting? Ijo sama yang merah ini tuh rumah pribumi, jadi aku taruh di dalam, makanya rasanya lebih welcome gitu. Modern banget. Sempit banget kalau ceilingnya pendek. Menurut aku ya, kita belum ngerasa memiliki kalau belum ada sejarahnya.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest tiga kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Orang setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat?
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim!
Simsalabim!
Abrakadabra!
Abrakadabra!
Singgobangkosir!
Singgobangkosir!
Pala botak gak bisa disisir!
Pala botak gak bisa.
Their existence is now being critically endangered.
Dia memiliki ekor yang sangat panjang, lebih panjang, jauh lebih panjang daripada badannya sendiri.
Tekniknya dia keluar, dia itu bergelombol menggunakan punggung temannya untuk naik.
Sebenarnya konservasi burung hantu di sini latar belakangnya jelas asas manfaat. Jadi kita pengen melestarikan burung, melestarikan satwa, tapi juga otomatis dampaknya ke masyarakat yang khususnya sekarang kalau di sini kan petani.
Berangkat aja dulu, kerjakan apa yang ada di depan kalian. Setidaknya kalian hari ini walaupun tidak mendapatkan uang, tapi kalian mendapatkan kesempatan.
Walaupun di awal-awal itu banyak sekali rintangan dan tantangan.
Kalian berproses aja dulu, jalan aja dulu. Kalau udah waktunya kalian untuk dapetin uang akan datang nyamperin kalian. Hal yang paling sangat utama untuk mengawali bisnis, ridho dan restu orang tua. Itu hal dan modal paling besar dalam mengawali usaha.
Welcome back to C Morning Show. The first story features a team. We have a three tame elephants and a Sampoinyet Conservation Response Unit in Aceh Jaya, Aceh, are assigned to ward off wild elephants who invade residents' farms and settlements. Aside from mitigating conflicts between residents and animals, these trained elephants are the face of the environmental education for locals and foreign tourists.
The Aceh Natural Resource Conservation has established six Conservation Response Units, or CRU, spread out in several regions that suffer from conflicts between residents and Sumatran elephants. One CRU is located in Ia Jeringa Village, Sampoinyet District, Aceh Jaya, Aceh. These trained Sumatran elephants are named Isabella and Johanna. The female trained elephants are assigned to remote villages in the Aceh Jaya district to mitigate conflicts between wild elephants and residents. Aside from Isabella and Johanna, there is also another elephant named Aziz, which at the time was not around during this report, as it was assigned to mitigate animal conflicts in other regencies. And when there are no conflicts between residents and animals, these elephants would often be visited by locals and foreign tourists. Visitors can witness the elephants being bathed by the mahout or elephant handler. Besides that, visitors can also take pictures with the protected elephants.
Ya, rutinitasnya ya seperti biasa. Kita selalu melakukan berupaya dalam sehari dua kali itu harus ada interaksi antara si mahout atau yang merawat gajah itu sendiri dengan si gajahnya. Bentuknya seperti memberi makan, kasih memberi minum, kemudian merawat seperti memandikan, itu untuk mendekatkan atau membangun semacam chemistry dengan si gajah itu sendiri.
Visitors that come admitted to being happy and amazed at seeing the Sumatran elephants directly. They would usually see the animals only on the internet, but now they can get closer to the elephants by seeing their activities.
Pernah lewat internet, jadi ini benar-benar baru lihat gajah, dan saya juga baru tahu ternyata gajah itu sangat cerdas ya. Jadi ketika mahout ya, dibilangnya mahout itu adalah penjaga ataupun orang yang mengawal gajah itu sendiri, ketika mengarahkan gajahnya, gajahnya langsung patuh gitu, mengangkat kakinya gitu, dan itu merupakan hal yang baru bagi saya ketika melihat hal tersebut. Dan ternyata mereka sangat interaktif gajah itu.
The three Sumatran elephants that are placed in Sampoinyet CRU are handled by six mahouts. The current population of Sumatran elephants are around 1,600 to 2,000, spread out in Aceh, North Sumatra, South Sumatra, Riau, Jambi, Bengkulu, and Lampung provinces. CTday News contributor reporting from Aceh Jaya, Aceh.
On to the next story, the clean water crisis that hits several areas in Jambi province has spared a village named Ibnu in Mastong District, Muaro, Jambi Regency. This resilience can be attributed to the village officials and its residents' efforts, who have managed a spring in their forest that provides access to safe drinking water directly from this natural source.
In Muaro, Jambi Regency, Jambi Province, there exists a natural spring in Ibnu Village. This remarkable spring plays a crucial role in meeting the clean water needs of around 300 households in the area, shielding its residents from the drought impact. Located within the forest, these springs water are not limited to Ibru village alone. Neighboring villages also benefit from its refreshing flow.
Alhamdulillah Pak, cara sistem pengelolaan di desa kita ini kan sekarang diolah oleh Bumdes Pak. Dan alhamdulillah juga selama 2008 air ini sudah berjalan ke seluruh masyarakat yang ada di desa Ibru dan ke desa tetangga.
Currently, the spring is administered by a village-owned enterprise. Local residents only need to pay a fee of 2,500 rupiah per cubic meter of water, or 1,000 rupiah if they prefer to have the water pipe directly into their homes.
Di Labang, semenjak ada air pump dari Desa Ibru, kami tidak merasa kekurangan air walau musim kemarau panjang. Tetap air mengalir dengan bersih sampai ke rumah.
Such is the significance of this spring, that even one of Indonesia's leading water companies once extended an offer to the village officials. They proposed the establishment of bottled water company within the village. See Today contributor reporting from Jambi.
From another part of Indonesia, we're flying to East Nusa Tenggara's Enggada Regency has a fairly abundant bamboo resources. And seeing such potential, a number of residents turned the natural gift into various handicraft products that have high economic value. Let's have a look.
Enggada Regency in East Nusa Tenggara is a home for a number of bamboo forests. Rows of trees are thriving and growing tall around the area. Bamboos are also seen growing around residential area in Bajawa and Golewa sub-districts. The abundant bamboo resources have been used by locals in Turotogut area as a raw material for household utensils, as well as agriculture and farming equipment. And over the time, they started to sell handicraft products, including poultry cages.
Bahkan ini bambu sendiri. Bambu itu disimpan oleh nenek moyang saya. Memang saya ada tanam bambu, dua tiga rumpun. Tapi karena bambu itu sudah ada nenek moyang yang simpan, maka saya gunakan itu. Saya gunakan dengan cara yang diajar oleh orang tua saya, itu bapak saya. Tampaknya saya jual ini sanggar ayam, ya saya bisa mengurus untuk ongkos langsung.
Now a number of craftsmen in Enggada are starting to grow their business by making furnitures and aesthetic decorations. Furniture such as bamboo chair sets, ornaments and miniatures, decorative lamps and bells are put on display at a number of tourism events in various regions. Aside from being sold to local residents, the products has also been sold to many people from across the world. Now, bamboo has become a part of locals' livelihood that provides gain for them. And along with the growth of Enggada tourism, the creative economy industry keeps on thriving.
Produk-produk ini dibuat dari bahan bambu, dan ini bambu betul-betul bambu asli Enggada. Enggada yang punya banyak potensi bambu belum dimanfaatkan oleh orang-orang Enggada sendiri, ya. Dan saya melihat ini adalah peluang. Mengapa? Karena bambu Enggada bahkan Flores ini berlimpah ruah. Sehingga saya mencoba mulai di tahun 2014, saya sudah mulai dengan peralatan sederhana, saya kerjakan, lalu kemudian saya jualnya di pinggir trotoar.
In an effort to further promote the bamboo products, residents established the so-called Bamboo Campus, a place where people can learn more about the plant. The building is constructed out of bamboo, and all of the structures, including roofs, walls, and columns, are made from local bamboo stems from Golewa. See Today contributor reporting from Enggada, East Nusa Tenggara.
The volcanic crater of Dieng Plateau in Banjarnegara, Central Java, has been a tourist attraction in the city for many years. Within this captivating site, tourists can explore the Kayangan Bridge and witness the emergence of new craters surrounding Sikidang Crater.
Dieng Plateau, located in Banjarnegara, Central Java, sits at an elevation of 2,800 meters above sea level and offers many unique tourist attractions. And among these sites is Sikidang Crater. Visitors can explore the area by traversing a 1-kilometer-long wooden bridge known as the Kayangan Bridge. Not only provides stunning vistas, the plateau also grants new craters appearance. As the visitors stroll along the Kayangan Bridge, they can hear the sound of sulfur smoke from the ground. The giant crater of Sikidang will also look closer if they walk further on the bridge.
Gak bisa itu udah keberapa kalinya ke Dieng, selalu kembali lagi, entah mau naik perahu atau naik bismo atau kemana. Ada banyak banget kan di sini, jadi punya daya tarik yang sangat memikat yang bikin kita selalu pengen balik lagi. Aku datang sama anak-anak gitu, jadi kita memang liburan keluarga. Karena aku udah sering kesini dan lihat keindahannya, aku pengen berbagi sama anak-anak.
On the weekends, Sikidang Crater bustles with visitors. And it is a popular belief among many that the sulfur vapor has skin-smoothing properties.
Untuk destinasi Sikidang, wisatawan bisa menikmati jalan di sepanjang jembatan Kahyangan. Kemudian ada magnet kepulan asap di mana itu bisa dinikmati dan saat ini sudah dikembangkan menjadi wisata panas bumi tentunya. Sama dengan destinasi yang lain seperti Candi, Kawah Sikidang menjadi magnet kunjungan wisatawan yang cukup tinggi.
In addition to its natural beauty, Sikidang Crater offers a variety of souvenirs for tourists. Visitors can find unique items like sulfur stones, as well as the region's signature fruit, karika or mountain papaya. Seeds the Contributor, reporting from Banjarnegara, Central Java.
Let's take a break, but we will have our first talk show after the break. Stay with us.
China has been racing against time for rescue and disaster relief work after a landslide on Monday struck a mountainous village in southwest China's Yunnan province.
Kenapa sih dia selalu mau eksis kalau aku syuting? Ijo sama yang merah ini tuh rumah pribumi. Jadi aku taruh di dalam, makanya rasanya lebih welcome gitu. Modern banget. Sempit banget kalau ceilingnya pendek. Menurut aku ya, kita belum ngerasa memiliki kalau belum ada sejarahnya.
Inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world.
Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you to stay tuned because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories, only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Kabinjai. Mau migrasi?
Cakep!
Anjay, aku di pot sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik ya.
Aduh ya Allah! Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain!
See you.
spicy.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Orang setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobang gosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business. Interesting and inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world. Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you to stay tuned because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories, only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Kebinjai. Mau migrasi?
Cakep!
Anjay, aku depot sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah! Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain!
Welcome back to the C Morning Show. Now, as you mentioned earlier, Messi, that yes. We are in our last 10 days of Ramadan. But do you realize during this month of Ramadan, we often receive invitations for iftar, dinner gatherings, so many activities, social activities, of course. Definitely. And we want to look and act our best, of course, because it's a special month. We want to be specials, and that's where our next guest comes in.
Indeed, Shafira. And Ibu Dahlia Sarjono is a social etiquette consultant who also teaches about table manners as well as etiquette on her social media. Now, she is here now in the studio and she's going to share some tips and tricks that can take us far in our daily routines and perhaps impress some of our peers around our social circle,
right. Let's say.
So, good morning, Ibu Dahlia.
Good morning.
First of all, thank you so much for coming to the studio this morning.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Before we have some etiquette practice, obviously, we're really looking forward to doing that later in the show, but let's dive into table manners and etiquette 101.
Oh my God. Are you struggling with that,
Miss? I am a little bit, yeah. I tend to have troubles, although I try my best to be very...
I'm too casual.
Yeah, you know. To each their own. So, Bu Dahlia, can you tell us how individuals typically incorporate table manners and etiquette when dining in formal settings, you know, versus casual gatherings? Yeah. What's the difference, really? Mm-hmm.
Well, actually, when you're talking about table manners, there's no difference between the formal dining or
casual.
Mm-hmm. because the manners is there, because the manner and etiquette is actually about respecting things, right?
Oh. Right.
Yeah, respecting others, okay. So that we respect the food, we respect the host who invite us, and we respect also the occasion. So that's why even though it's a casual one, I believe that if everyone practice the manner, then you will be impeccable.
Okay. So basically, it's about respect
others. That's right.
Not just
not just being ourself. I mean, yeah, it's okay to be ourself, but right. still, if we are, we got the invitation, we have to know who is inviting us. So we have have to show respect, not just the person, but also the food.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
we have to treat food, you know, very good. You know,
right,
we have to be grateful for the food. Mm-hmm. So, speaking about the table manner and etiquette, especially in a, you know, in a dining table or in our social activity, what role do cultural differences play in the implementation of table manners and especially etiquette around the world?
Well, everyone. If we put it that way, because there, like I said earlier, that the table manners is we practice it everywhere actually in a social dining or in a formal dining.
Yeah.
But around the world, they also have custom. So there where the culture comes in, you know. So for example, like when you eat pizza, actually pizza is not eat. You're not going to eat pizza with fork and. Knife. Yeah.
Right.
You're supposed to eat it by hand. That's how the Italian culture do.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But of course, when they serve pizza during the formal dining, then you use that utensil.
Mm.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
How is that contradictions going? I mean, the local or the original people who invented pizza, of course, Italian, they eat by hands and everything. So in other culture, they use utensils.
Actually, the other cultures, they just want to be nice, probably, right?
Right.
Yeah, they want to be look. They want to look classy, but that's not the custom.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So, it's kind of tricky.
There's also another thing where in Italy, when you eat pizza, you're not supposed to fold it.
Uh-huh.
But when you're in New York, for example, the pizza you fold so that it remains straight.
Oh, okay, because it's big.
Because it's big, because it's a big slice as well.
Yeah, because it's always triangle, right?
Yeah.
You fold it on the edge and you eat it from the front.
Okay.
Yeah, like that. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
So, that applies obviously to a lot of different types of eating.
Mm-hmm.
For example, I saw this video where there was this person from who works for the royal family that the way that Queen Elizabeth used to eat a banana was by opening it with a knife and fork and then one as well.
Okay, like to peel off?
Basically peeling it off and then and then cutting it into little slices.
Okay.
So obviously that's considered fine dining perhaps. Mm. But for those people who aren't familiar with fine dining, it might seem intimidating.
Yeah.
You know. So how can we, first of all, how can we kind of introduce ourselves to it? Mm-hmm. How can we get used to it? And finally, how can we enjoy it eventually? Learn to enjoy it.
When you're invited for a dinner, then of course you have to enjoy it, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So to know that, then you have to practice it. Nowadays, we are so lucky because we have social media, we have Google, we have YouTube. You can learn from it. But of course, however, practice make perfect, right? So you have to really have a class, table manner class, to really know where is the difference between the European and the American way of table manner. And also Oriental, of course.
Nice. Speaking about practice, practice makes perfect.
Perfect, right? Yes.
We have no idea about table manner, especially the European. Probably we saw it on television or from the movie. Now let's practice it together, Bu. Since you are here with us,
let's go.
We have a table setting over there.
All right.
Can we just go there? Yes. All right.
Let's go.
Okay, please.
Yeah.
You go first, Ibu Dahlia. Messi, where you wanna?
I will be on that.
Okay, you're there. Ibu Dahlia will be in the middle, and I will sit here.
All right.
Okay. Wow, my mom is going to be crazy. Lot of these things out. Okay.
This one.
Now to sit properly.
Yes. Right.
Okay.
This is another. Okay.
Are you okay? You good?
Yeah, I'm okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
How can we sit properly so we can enjoy the table setting?
The table setting and the table manner, right?
Mm. Yeah. Right.
Okay. Mm. So when you sit, it's just the people say that You were the finishing school at the finishing school where ladies usually do that, mm-hmm. or gentlemen also.
Okay.
Then you feel like a balloon pulling up your head.
Oh.
So you will sit straight up.
Okay.
Right, straight up.
Yes.
Yeah, and actually, if you're sitting on a proper table, mm-hmm. because we are not,
yeah.
not in a dining table, right? Yeah, it's like this. It's like five fingers, so you are not too leaning on the table,
okay.
not also too far from the table. So,
oh, okay.
So the ample way is the five.
Five fingers,
right? Okay.
Five centimeters.
Five around. Centimeters. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Right. Okay. No, a little far.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Try that again.
Like this.
Yeah. So we have to be closer.
Adjust the chair. Then.
Adjust the chair.
All right.
Adjust the chair.
Okay.
Forward a little bit. Okay.
Okay.
Still.
Yeah.
It's not a proper table.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm okay. Coming back.
Okay. So mm-hmm. let's begin. Where do we start with?
Okay. Now, when you're invited by someone, by anybody, mm-hmm. of course we have to wait for the host mm-hmm. to begin or to start to invite to start. So let's say, for example, okay, Shafira, Messi, let's begin. Let's start eating. Then we eat. Mm. Yeah. So don't, even though you're so hungry, then don't start it. Don't start before the host starts, right?
Okay.
Yeah, right. And then you know that there are so many things here, right? Mm. Then we have to know first also where to put your finger or where to put your utensils, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So it's usually from out to inside.
Okay.
Yeah. So. Usually it's more than this. If you notice in a fine dining, there are so many utensils in
here. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And in here also, this one is supposed to be for the bread.
Okay.
Yeah, the bread before the dining, right?
Okay.
And usually there is also the butter knife.
Okay.
So the one that is more
small
one. Yeah.
Okay.
Small one, that, right. So this one is for when we are having middle food. Like when we share the food,
mm-hmm.
then
okay.
we bring our.
Oh, we put it here.
Yeah, we put it here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So everything is actually, you know, don't dump everything into your plate. Yeah. So put it, take it one by one.
Oh,
yeah.
So each plate has a different function then.
It's true. This one is for example later when we have salad.
Yeah, oh,
right.
Okay.
So we put
now
the salad.
I get it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I have a question because I tend to struggle with this whenever I go fine dining because these plates kind of look similar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So can you tell the difference just based on the positioning or is there a shape difference as well?
Shape and positioning.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh.
But usually when you have butler, this plate is not to be here. So somebody will come and serve course by course.
Oh.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
But this one is the normal one. Mm. The normal setting is usually with the bread, right?
Okay.
So the bread is here. So some people might get confused which one is which, yeah.
Mm.
Because we also have some glasses, right? A lot of glasses. So they say it. So this is the theory. So the secret is it's like the B and the D. So this is B and this is D.
Mm-mm.
So the B is for the bread. So we know that the bread is on the left side.
Yeah.
So
and the drink.
Yes, right. Oh, so all drinks are here. So that's why they are on the right.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Somebody might mistaken in a round table, fine dining events, gala dinner.
Mm-mm.
Oops. That's my glass. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. Someone took another glass.
Yeah.
Not yours.
Yeah,
it's always on your right.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, that's true. And this one is they call it water goblet. So the water goblet is usually smaller or large like this.
Mm-hmm.
And behind it, there will be red wine glasses, white wine glasses, and later on there might be whiskey, spirits, other spirits glasses.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Like a cocktails thing.
That's cocktails, yeah.
Probably. Okay.
Yeah. Cocktails come first.
Oh, cocktails comes first.
Yeah, cocktail is before.
So we are going to bring that a glasses then.
No. Yeah.
Because they serve
in the beginning, right?
Yeah, sometimes they do.
During
the networking, before the dining.
The canapé and
yes, right, oh, right. That's okay. Cocktail comes at the welcoming.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, at the welcoming.
Yeah. Budahlia, after you explain a little bit about this, I noticed about this one thing, especially in a family gathering. We are in Ramadan and Eid are coming in the next 10 days. What about family, you know, table manners implemented in a family who have children, we can say about toddlers. How parents can teach those children about the table manners? Because kids can be very, you know, challenging.
Right,
they want to just grab the food.
So you do by example. So don't just tell your kids that, don't do that, don't do that. But it's also that we're doing it right there. Yeah, we're doing it like that, and we say to them that we expect them to do the same thing.
You know? Oh,
so,
yeah.
Okay. So you exhibit the one that's supposed to be.
So basically, they will learn by the experience from seeing from their parents.
Right, of course. Okay, interesting. So obviously, you know, we talked about earlier how cultural differences create different table manners as well. But how do societal norms and expectations influence the adoption of specific table manners? You know, how did they come about, really? And how did they come to be in different social circles, really?
Yeah, this is like, for example, European and American also different, right? And the norm also in even in our country, in Indonesia, we have several region also. Yeah. They have also some customs. So, but in terms of table manners, the manner are the same. The etiquette are the same. We expect everybody to respect that etiquette. But however, we know where we are. Like earlier, we said about the
respect the host.
Yeah, respect the host.
Right.
Yeah, okay. And also about eating pizza, for example. And in America, if you're eating, for example, the steak, you're cutting with this right. After you cutting, knife and fork.
Yeah.
After you cut, then you put the
knife
in, and you change.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, this not really, supposed to be like this,
Yeah. How we change the forks? Because we used to eat by our using right hand.
So we change the fork and put it on your right hand and.
We cut it first.
Yes.
And we put the knife, and then we switch the hands.
Yes, we switch.
And then we grab the meat.
The meat, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. And eat.
Oh,
while in Europe, in Europe, we remain eating with the left one. While in here, we know that everyone eating with spoon, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So, like that. So that's the custom. And also, if we are in the Oriental, like for example in Japan or in China, right? We eat with the chopsticks, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there. It's okay to slurp because the noise you get, that's the to show that's the respect of the food.
Basically
while on the other on the other part of the of the world, then it's not polite.
So basically we have to learn about another culture so we know how to respect others. You know, by probably implementing what they are familiar with.
Right.
Sure,
we know how to respect. Well, we just not implementing some culture. It's not fit to other culture. Then.
Yeah.
It's very important. Very interesting.
Yeah. So it's like respect others the way you want to be respected too, right?
But again, respect them in their culture as well.
It's true.
Yes.
Interesting.
So, Ibu Dahlia, we live in a modern culture and modern society. We oftentimes we are served by so many unique kind of food, not just steak or bread or something. It's fusion and everything.
Mm. Yeah.
And we want to implementing the table manner and etiquette. With the with the twist, modern and a culture, how we can fit into this society and dining habit during this Ramadan?
during this Ramadan? That's a nice question, because now we are in the Ramadan season, right?
The
festive season. Yeah. Okay, during the Ramadan, of course, we are invited by probably our elderly or big family, right? Mm-hmm. So to fit in there, of course, we have to know who's the host again and who is the more senior than you, right? So that you have to follow their rules, the rules of the house also, right? Then first and foremost, then you have to thank them that they're inviting us to come, right? Then you know, when during the when we are eating, then we also compliment the food.
We tend to forget about that.
Thank you, compliment, that's nice. See, especially they really prepare it for you, right? Prepare for the season, for the Ramadan, so so this is nice and everything. Then somebody might have a special dish, specialty of that family, right?
That's the thing.
Yeah.
We tend to forget about that. To say thank you for the guest, for the host, and then complimenting the food.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
We're so busy with the knife.
Yeah. Oh, talking about the kids just now also, that the three words that we are also have to always remember, that's also saying thank you, greeting hello, right? So salam, of course, salim. Mm-hmm. Then also excuse me when you're, you know, so it's minta maaf, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Again, it's all about showing respect and appreciation, isn't it?
Yeah. Basically, it's the basic manners.
Exactly. Well, we like to show our appreciation to you, Budalia, for coming to our studio.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming. Thank you so much.
Are we not going to do this?
Oh yeah.
Let's do that together
We have this napkin, right? And when we are in a restaurant and fine dining restaurant, don't flap the napkin when you unfold it. Sometimes people tend to sit. Don't do this. And also don't put it in here, right? We unfolded it. So this is nicely already folded, like triangle, like this. We put it like this, right?
Okay.
Like this. Or if you want to just put it in a two fold like this, also fine.
This is
also fine.
But it's okay to unfold the napkins and then we fold it again.
Yeah, fold like it again. This. And this part is closer to your body, Yeah, it's always on the lap,
Always on the lap.
Mm-hmm. Put it, this one is on here. Mm-hmm. There are two ways, actually. Some might do this in here, and some might do this in here, on the other side.
Okay.
On the other way. But I prefer this way, because of what? Why we do this? Mm-hmm. This is when we are finishing the food, and we want to tap to
mouth
and everything.
Right. Yes.
We do it like this. So we open it. Oh. And we do it like this.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So everything is hiding behind it, right?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And closed.
Yeah, neat and closed.
Yeah, so we can do it properly.
Yeah. And tap, yeah? And don't do it like this.
Don't slash it.
Don't slash around.
We are going to ruin the lipstick, because we want to still look good.
Right.
To take a picture together.
We're learning so much, aren't we?
Oh, my God.
So it's like this. And why we put it this one on the other side? Mm-hmm. Because anything that is messy, then anybody won't see it, right? Still undercover.
So we can cover it up.
Yes.
Oh, very nice. Such a good tips, Bu.
Thank you so much. Later on, we might do this, right? For the coffee and tea.
Okay.
On the other.
Maybe next time we are going to learn another thing from you, especially how to drink a tea or coffee properly.
Stay tuned for that.
After Ramadan, we have Eid celebrations. Probably we're going to see you here again, Budalia.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Really insightful. And I'm going to use it when I had a family gathering.
We're going to be impressing our
peers. Very challenging. It's very challenging.
Indeed.
Especially for implementing in my family. It's another level.
Alrighty, everybody. That was Dahlia. That was Bu Dahlia. Thank you so much for coming. We're going to take another short break meanwhile. And after the break, we're going to have a special performance from Juicy Lucy with their new single, Ha Ha.
Properly, Ha Ha Ha.
Ha Ha Ha. Ha Ha Ha. Ha Ha Ha.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat.
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim.
Simsalabim.
Abrakadabra.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobang gosir.
Singgobang gosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business. Interesting and inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world. Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you just stay tuned because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories Only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Kabinjai. Mau migrasi?
Cakep!
Anjay, aku di pot sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh, ya Allah! Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia nggak sebaik itu, nggak sebagus itu, nggak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain!
Oh,
yang sakit sebenarnya. Bisa-bisanya kau anggapku bahagia. Tak jelaskah ku kecewa. Sekuat-kuatnya tak mungkin selamanya. Toh kita manusia bisa tapi seujungnya ku harus rela biarpun aku kecewa.
Lucy, everybody, with their latest single, Ha Ha Ha.
Ha Ha Ha. What is your favorite part?
I have to say the chorus. You know, the one that goes, Ha Ha Ha. Na 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 na. Because I think, right. I think there's a little bit of irony in the song, yes. And that they're laughing, you know, but they're also laughing about something sad.
Yeah, I was wondering how to say the correct ha ha. I mean, like, it should be a sad song, right? Like,
yeah.
Or.
I think the first time you did it was absolutely perfect because, yes. You know, it's sad, right?
Right.
But why don't we just ask the people themselves, right?
Okay, let's ask them. So today, we're gonna talk not only about their single, but we'll be having a chat about their journey, and we will also playing a fun games later in our talk show. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Juicy Lucy, Uwan, and friends.
Yeah, guys. Thank you so much sudah hadir di situ deh. Yeah. Ada kita, ada Uwan, ada Dennis, ada Bina, dan ada Zamzam. Anyway, guys, congrats, you know, udah single terbarunya, udah rilis yang berjudul Haha. Mungkin kan tadi kita sempat debat sedikit kayak cara bicara hahanya tuh kayak gimana sih? Kalau misalkan yang kayak kalian bayangin tuh kayak gimana? Kayak
gimana ya? Kayak ketawa karir gitu.
Oke.
Nah, kalau lihat judulnya nih kayak ketawa tapi penuh makna gitu loh.
Yeah.
Ceritain sedikit dong kayak lagunya tuh kayak gimana sih? Kayak dapat inspirasinya dari mana?
Kalau saya sih nggak tahu ya, selalu suka sama sesuatu hal yang kontradiktif. Jadi waktu disuruh bikin hahaha ini, ya kebayangnya lagi sedih sih.
Oke. Okay.
Nggak tahu kenapa yang kontradiktif tuh seneng aja liat.
Oke. Okay. Yeah. Tapi disusunnya itu dengan cara yang indah, karena nggak kayak tapi kayak hahaha itu tuh idenya dari mana, si nadanya dan lain sebagainya sehingga bisa tercipta lagu itu.
Tahun lalu ya, kalau nadanya yeah. Kita refnya doang itu lama, nyimpen refnya doang tuh lama banget sih. Gitu nyari-nyari, haming-haming gitunya lama juga.
Kalau inspirasinya sih susah ya. Ya dicari-cari terus yang ini nih gitu, ini nih yang paling pas. Itu 3 kali ganti kali hahanya.
Oke, okay, bikin liriknya berapa lama? Siapa yang bikin?
Dennis.
Dennis. Okay.
Dennis, of course.
Bikin liriknya sekitar korusnya doang tuh setengahnya jadi, terus stuck tuh didiemin setahun baru bikin verse-nya, baru korusnya dilanjutin, cukup lama sih tuh.
Setahun lebih kayaknya.
Setahun lebih. Nah kan itu kan lu yang nulis ya, Mas Dennis ya. Tapi kalau kita lihat di sosmed kalian tuh ada banyak kerjasama, ada banyak kolaborasi dengan penyanyi dan artis-artis lain seperti Rizky Febian, ada Elsa Japasal dan Nabila Takiyah juga. Dimana mereka membawa lagu kalian yang Haha dan sebaliknya kalian juga membawa lagu mereka. Ya. Itu sebenarnya konsepnya seperti apa sih?
Emang konsepnya setiap kita keluar single selalu pengen ada kolabs gitu. Dan ya yang kekenal-kenal aja gitu. Kebetulan kayak Iki kan kenal. Sama sekalian Ki kalau mahal ininya mau nggak gitu. Ternyata mau juga. Kalau Echa tuh yang surprise banget kayak lagi selebriti keras gitu sama Echa kan sering lewat di FYP gitu.
Yeah, yeah.
Terus tiba-tiba dapat kontaknya manajerku terus dihubungi aja abis syuting dia langsung itu merinding sih.
Oke, okay, that's really great. Nah, Messi, yang aku seneng banget dari Juicy Lucy itu tuh jadi lirik mereka itu simple tapi puitis tapi ringan gitu. Kayak misalnya kalau misalnya aku lihat nih di beberapa kayak kalimatnya kau puji dulu lupa amarahku. Terus entah Selasa keberapa. Terus banyak deh sialan, bahkan sialan dia, I mean like. Aku gak pernah nyangka kalimat sialan itu bisa indah terdengar. Iya, di sebuah lagu.
Padahal kesel
yeah. Kan gitu. Kok bahasa Inggrisnya damn it gitu. Man. Ternyata bisa terdengar indah. Nah itu berarti yang bikin semuanya Mas Dennis atau yeah. Ada kontribusi dari yang lain? Atau mungkin Mas Dennis ada bakat sastra gitu?
Apa background? Bakat, kalau kata orang Sunda bakatku butuh.
Kok bakatku butuh, betul. Gimana nih Mas Dennis?
Kalau bakat sih nggak tahu ya. Cuma saya itu ketika punya lagu dan orang bengong nggak ngerti itu agak males ya pas manggung. Jadi mencoba sama ditanya ini tentang apa tuh agak susah jelasinnya. Jadi sebisa mungkin di lagu dibikin simple banget. Sesimpel-simpelnya aja sih.
Easy listening okay. Benar.
Masuk
biar orang gampang nangkep.
Oke, okay, pas haha itu pas lagi momen apa tuh tiba-tiba hahaha.
Enggak itu disuruh label.
Oh gitu.
Challenge.
Kita enggak bikin lagu dari hahaha.
Oke,
jadi adalah hahaha ini gitu. Kalau yang di belakang ini kontribusinya apa kira-kira?
Nih kita nemenin.
Nihil.
Kalau misalnya mungkin kontribusi di kira-kira nadanya enaknya gini nih.
Oh tentu, haha, gitu. Ada.
Ada nggak beberapa?
Nggak sih kita tugasnya lebih di yang lain. Gam-gam tuh kayak ngurusin semua teknis di panggung. Pakai alat apa aja terus. Kru-nya siapa aja gitu-gitu. Produksi. Paling ngerti produksi.
Yang paling PR jadi Bina sih, soalnya Bina dulu tuh pemain saksofon di kita tuh.
Oke.
Iya.
Murtad ke bass.
Terus dia dari nol banget main bass karena kita press budget ya. Misalnya pakai additional kan. Sekarang ya Bina maksudnya dari pemain saksofon terus disuruh main bass. Bassnya juga bahkan bassnya beli dari additional kita ya. Jadi dia lumayan pressure tuh.
Okay. Kebanyakan kalau kita tuh emang tahu lagunya tuh pas di studio.
I see. Oke.
Lagu serahkan ke Dennis saja.
Yeah.
Oke. Bin rekaman lagu apa?
Ini bener-bener langsung belajar di tempat itu ya?
Yo, itu disuruh rekaman saya lagi demam waktu itu.
Oh iya. Wow.
Satu lagu cobain ditanyain ke anak-anak gimana nih dilempar. Pendapatnya beda semua, malah tambah pusing. Jadi dari situ udah deh, ntar aja mereka taunya di studio. Iya.
Tapi kalian pernah ada konflik gak kalau terkait dengan kayak direksi lagunya akan kemana gitu? Dan cara mengatasinya gimana?
Iya ada beberapa versi waktu itu kayak lagu apa yang...
Ya itu lagu Lantas pertama kali dilempar ke mereka malah jadi 5 versi, jadi bingung nih. Akhirnya yang kita bikin di awal aja lah, udahlah nggak
usah dibilang. Akhirnya balik ke versi awal.
Gitu.
Dan itu emang versi sekarang juga kan. Dan you know, you guys have worked very hard dan kalian udah berhasil meraih gelar prestigious bagi duo atau grup pop terbaik di ajang Grammy Awards 2023. That is amazing guys.
Yes.
Jadi makna penghargaan ini untuk kalian seperti apa?
Wah gila sih ya, dapat award sih.
Soalnya dari kalahnya dulu. Sering.
Ngeliatin artis-artis kalau dapat award.
Dari kecil ya nonton kecil, acara award kayak.
Wah ntar ngomong apa ya. Kejadian. Bingung sih sebenarnya pas dapet ternyata kok bisa ya gitu. Masih.
Pernah terlintas gak sih di kepala waktu pas Juicy Lucy ini kan dari 2010 ya. Dengan gonta-ganti personil akhirnya sekarang sampai di sini. Terus terlintas kayak kita pasti bisa dapat penghargaan, kita pasti bisa sebesar ini di posisi ini.
Wah, enggak sih kalau nyampe sana. Ini aja kemarin mendapat AMI Awards aja sama sekali enggak kepikiran sih. Kalau ya sebelumnya kan pernah dapat nominasi beberapa kali kayak ambisi banget ini harus menang, kita harus menang. Taunya kalah. Pas kemarin mah boro-boro menang.
Mau manggung ya?
Kita mau manggung ke Jogja, menang.
Yeah. Kalian inget gak pertama kali kalian dengar kalau misalkan kalian dinominasi awalnya itu kalian lagi ngapain?
Yang kaget tuh yang tahun pertama.
Iya, iya yang kalah itu yang kaget malah yang terakhir-terakhir ya. Kita tuh udah enggak mau datang award lagi gara-gara kita udah niat banget waktu itu di dapat nominasi pertama udah niat banget pakai stylish, pakai apa. yang menangnya Ariel enggak datang. Ya. Udah nyewa mobil ya. Mobilnya Elf ngelihat Agnesmo di depan pakai Range Rover, pakai apa. Wah, kita pakai Elf kuning. Kalau supirnya mas, depan aja mas, malu. Yang lain pakai Alphard ya.
Nah, tapi gak apa-apa, Kan dari kerja keras yang kecil-kecil akhirnya bisa.
Ya, akhirnya.
Alhamdulillah.
Gitu.
Nah, ngomongin genre lagu. Aku gak tahu nih, ini ke pop, ke jazz atau kayak gimana gitu. Dan apakah mungkin nanti gitu akan tetap stay di genre itu atau ngulik yang lain. Apalagi lagi Ramadan seperti ini. Apakah lebih religius nanti lagunya atau seperti apa?
Kalau dulu sih lebih mau nyeritain apa, musiknya kayak gimana tuh gak mikirin genrenya, tapi yang pas tuh, kalau lukisan tuh yang pas tuh kayak gimana sih gitu, kayak ini jadi lagu tuh kayak gimana yang cocok sesuai yang mau disampaikan. Tapi kalau sekarang lebih ke mut-mutan aja sih, kayak aduh pengennya kayak gini, lagi pengen kayak gini, kayak si Alan tuh ada Silk Sonic kan keluar album, ini pengen bikin kayak gini, bikinnya gitu.
Ibaratnya tuh apa yang keluar dari hati lah ya langsung.
Iya, kalau influence apa gitu. Terus pengennya gimana gitu.
Oke, ini seru banget obrolannya. Yes. Tapi sebelum kita ngobrol-ngobrol mungkin kita ice breaking dulu.
Oke.
Kita akan bermain games, kita akan melakukan tes kekompakan. Kita lihat apakah benar-benar kompak atau tidak.
Game dulu ya.
Oke, Messi.
Games ya.
Nah, ini dia. Messi bakal ngambil ada papan. Papan dan juga ada apa namanya pulpen ya, spidol gitu. Nah jadi nanti kita bakal ngasih tahu pertanyaan gitu. Tapi harus cepet-cepetan jawabnya. Jadi nanti akan dikasih sekitar waktu 3 detik doang. Nanti saat pertanyaannya udah dilempar oleh aku atau enggak Messi, nanti langsung diumpetin dulu jawabannya, baru nanti di reveal.
Oke,
sudah siap?
Siap.
Oke. Kita mulai.
Mulai.
Pertanyaan nomor pertama. Lagu apa yang membuatkan atau lagu apa yang membutuhkan waktu yang paling cepat untuk dibuat?
Lagu kita.
3, 2, 1. Oke, stop. Umpetin dulu. Oke. Ini yang di belakang udah? Oke, siap.
Bentar. Aku mau mastiin dulu nih. Kalau misalkan mereka jawabannya kompak gimana ya nanti ya? Kalian jangan break up dulu ya.
Pasti gak kompak sih.
Oh iya, karena emang ide kalian beda semua dan itulah yang membuat band ini sangat kayak keren gitu ya. Alright, let's check it out guys. Jawabannya adalah... Saya nikah terlalu tinggi, tanpa tergesa dan lantas.
Ini semuanya
beda semua.
Pasti.
Oke. Kenapa ini?
Gue jadi penasaran sama
Ini bikin sama Dennis 15 menit.
Oke, ini 15 menit. Terlalu tiga.
Dia bikin sendiri kan, soalnya dia yang nikah.
Dia rekor nih, bikin lagu, gak mikir sekali jalan.
Oke.
Berapa menit kira-kira ini 15 menit?
3 kali.
Wow.
Yang di belakang berapa menit?
Ini karena pas rekamannya aja cepet sih, lantas.
Pas rekaman.
Gak tahu kan bikinnya.
Oke, yang di belakang.
Tanpa tergesa soalnya. Instrumennya cuma gitar doang ya?
Iya,
Oke.
Itu kita bikin di mobil tanpa tergesa.
Kan lama ya bikinnya?
Iya, lumayan lama.
Oke.
Tapi berarti enggak ada yang kurang dari 3 menit ya?
Ada. Ini menang, sih
ya. Yang benar. Kalian tuh bikin di mana-mana, di mobil iya.
Ya, itu di ya kebenaran aja kali ya, lagi kepikiran, lagi sedih.
Iya sih. Gue jadi pertanyaan
follow up. Party.
Kalian tuh paling aneh bikin tempat yang paling aneh yang dibikin lagu itu di mana? Yang paling unik.
Masih mobil sih ya.
Mobil.
Masih. Mobil. Di hotel unik kan?
Hotel biasa aja lah.
Sekarang second question, are you ready?
Ready.
Oke, pertanyaan adalah siapa di antara kalian yang suka panik ketika mau manggung? 3, 2.
Udah pasti sama ini.
Pasti sama.
Ini baru kompak. Ini pasti kompak.
Langsung aku.
Oke, sama semua.
Jadi gue penasaran, itu cara kalian atau cara lu mengatasi ini tuh kayak gimana?
Kita gak mengatasi.
Saya gak mau mengatasi.
Mungkin gak tarik nafas, tarik dikeluarin, nafas. Tetap enggak.
Enggak bisa, ya. Udahlah.
Itu mah kodrat itu mah.
Oh, kodrat.
Cuma udah dari sananya.
His blood is traveling really fast gitu kayaknya.
Kita bantu kasih kambing biasanya.
Iya.
Panggung.
Oke.
Tapi lu selama manggung kayak gitu terus atau sempat kayak lama-lama jadi menurun sendiri kayak jadi lebih tenang?
Enggak sih, kadang-kadang.
Kenceng ya?
Kadang-kadang.
Enggak, lurus cuma kitanya udah turun. Ya emang lurus aja terus.
Ketakutannya cuma ada trouble di saat manggung gitu doang sih, bukan tegang karena mau manggungnya.
Malah kita tenang kalau jam-jam panik.
Pas lu tadi mau manggung di sini sempat ada khawatirnya juga enggak? Mm-hmm. Ada tekanan juga.
Yang paling lama tadi siapa?
Jadi paling enggak iya kan paling bikin lama dia. Justru kalau dia tenang kita ini something wrong, man.
Malah jadi panik.
Ya, malah jadi panik.
Aduh. Okay. Sorry jadi kebuka nih.
Gak emang harus dibuka.
Oh iya. Yeah. Sure. Alright, okay, last question guys. Siapa musisi yang menginspirasi Wan?
Wan.
Bagi menjadi sebagai seorang vokalis di band Juicy Lucy.
Oh.
Oke, okay, dikasih 3 detik lagi deh. 3, 2, 1. Oke. Let's refill. The answer.
Ya? The answer is.
Ya maaf kan dong.
Afgan.
Oh ya udah.
Kalau jawaban kalian?
Rio Febrian. Duta berarti ya.
Oh, Rio Febrian.
Dan
Rio Febrian tau enggak?
Iya.
Oh, Rio Febrian. Yeah, of course.
Iya. Yeah. Itu.
Jawabannya siapa?
Masa enggak tahu kan?
Adele.
Oh, Adele. Oh ya bisa, Adele.
Bisa juga.
Adele
istri. Love.
Jelasin dong kayak inspirasinya dari mana? Kayak how did you get to know Afghan? How did you get to be inspired by Afghan?
His first single, Terima Kasih Cinta, itu yang bikin saya pengen nyanyi sih.
Oh. Okay.
Padahal dulu lagi jadi atlet main bola dulu.
Lelunya atau
Afghan? Gua.
Oh, gua. Terus dari situ?
Ya dari situ kayak, ih kok Afghan kayak serak-serak becek gitu ya, seksi gitu. Jadi waktu itu di mobil selalu dengerin album dia. Lagu Terima Kasih Cinta itu yang bikin saya belajar nyanyi gitu.
Iya. Yeah.
Oke, okay, dan kayaknya ada kemiripan sih.
Amin.
Suara.
Amin. Iya.
Iya gak sih karakternya?
Kalau pitch kalian ada mirip juga gak sih?
Kalau pitch agak mirip, tapi kalau bagus jauh.
Gitu dong. Kayaknya juga bagus.
Kalian juga.
Iya, bagus dan ceria sendiri.
Oke, last but not least.
Yes.
Hahaha udah ya, single. Nah kira-kira apa yang bisa fans harapkan dari Juicy Lucy ini di tahun 2024? Apalagi yang bakal dibuat oleh Juicy Lucy?
Nanti abis lebaran kita ada album buat.
Ya.
Ada satu lagu lagi yang
lagi di
just came up gitu mau direkam itu karena ini sih ada satu lagu baru ya yang harus kita rekam satu lagi jadi buat album jadi 12 lagu ya.
12 lagu.
Bocorin dong lagunya kayak gimana? Penasaran gue.
Lagunya lucu.
Optimis kah atau apa?
Judulnya
Lampu Kuning.
Lampu Kuning.
Lampu Kuning.
Iya.
Ini bakal kan kalau aku lihat di Juicy Lucy kan banyak yang kalian tuh memposisikan jadi orang ketiga. Lampu Kuning ini orang ketiga juga gak?
Oh enggak, Lampu Kuning ini buat orang yang kalau kata orang Sunda belegu gitu.
Okay. Tetap ya dengan bodohnya.
Dengan bodohnya.
Bodoh.
Ya kan kita bikin bodoh ya. Kayak udah lampu kuning, masih kepedean.
Harusnya lampu merah, stop
lampu
aja.
Lampu merah, stop ya? Aja.
Iya kan banyak yang lampu kuning malah digas ya.
Iya betul.
85% orang Indonesia lampu kuning digas.
Ini kayaknya salah satunya semua. Are you?
No, yeah. I'm not. Hopefully.
Saya mah kuning ke merah udah,
ngedrift. Udah
ngepot. Ngedrift langsung.
Kalau saya merah, digas.
Kayaknya bakal relate ke semua orang.
Amin, semoga pada relate pokoknya.
Alright, Wan, Dennis, Gina, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you the time.
Lucy, ya udah ada di sini ya mas ya.
Once again guys, thank you so much for coming to see today.
Thank you.
You know, it's been great. And best of luck dengan all of your work, all of your albums.
Bisa main, abis album bisa main di sini lagi ya.
Yes, that'd be absolutely great. We'd love to.
Thank you so much.
We'd really love to.
Okay. You know? So, all right, we still have one more performance from Uwan and the gang. And please welcome Juicy Lucy with Sialandia.
Asik.
Seribu jalan di dunia, mengapa berpapasan bertemu dia? pergi tanpa kata menyapa sudut mata hafal rupanya lupa bahwa lupakannya tak mudah tapi itu senyuman yang ku suka sepertinya sama tatapan hasrat hayawasi yang lama kau ajak bicara seketika kembali ku jatuh cinta sialan dia sakitan air mata sia-sia dari begitu banyak manusia mengapa lagi-lagi dia yang ku jumpa malam hangat tapi ku terjaga rindukan dirinya si pusat kecewa lupa bahwa lupakannya tak mudah tapi tatapan khas matanya masih yang lama kau ajak bicara seketika kembali ku jatuh cinta sialan dia sakitkan air mata sia-sia tempat untuknya oh, sepertinya sama kesempatannya masih yang lama kau ajak bicara seketika kembali ku jatuh cinta sialan dia sakitan air mata
interesting and inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world. Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you to stay tuned because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Kabinjai. Mau migrasi?
Cakep!
Anjay, aku depot sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah! Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain!
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Yeah.
spicy.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa.
Back to the See Morning Show. The Catholic faithful of Jakarta are celebrating Easter by attending an early morning Sunday Mass at the Jakarta Cathedral. The country's largest cathedral will host 4 hybrid Mass sessions throughout the day, which will include pontifical and family Mass. To find out more about the ongoing Easter celebration and church service, we are now connected with our news team, Arya Siddhartha and Ferry Ahmad, reporting live from the cathedral. Arya, so how's the Mass going on this morning? Arya? All right, we try to connect back with Arya, who is at the cathedrals. Arya, are we connected with you now? All right.
Currently, the Pontifical Mass is just about to start. We just saw rows of cardinals and bishops making their way inside the cathedral to start the Mass, which starts at 8:30. And the Pontifical Mass is one of the 4 sessions that will be held here in the Jakarta Cathedral to celebrate the culmination of Holy Week. Now, the general Easter Sunday Mass was held earlier today at the bright early morning of 6 a.m., which saw worshippers fill the cathedral's 2,700 seats, which are both partly indoor and some outdoor. Another general Mass, which will be open to the public, will also be held later at 5 p.m. Aside from the 2 Masses that I've mentioned, there will also be the Pontifical Mass starting right now, which will be attended by cardinals and bishops as well as other church officials. Aside, in addition to that, there will also be the Family Mass, which will be attended by mostly children who are attending Sunday school here at the cathedral. Now, today is, of course, the culmination of the Holy Week, which is the most important week in Catholicism, commemorating the final 8 days of the life of Jesus Christ. And the Jakarta Cathedral has been celebrating the Holy Week all the way since Maundy Thursday. So this has been a definitely very lively, very packed, very busy week for Jakarta's Cathedral as they finally culminated here on Easter Sunday. Now the, however, in addition to all of that, this year the Cathedral is also sprinkling along some very unique and special decor, one might say, around the cathedral grounds. As you can see, and also a lot of the worshipers here in attendance can also see several ornaments and statues that symbolize Batawi as well as Dayak culture. Now, of course, this is, according to the church officials, this is in order to symbolize the imminent move of the nation's capital from Jakarta to Nusantara in East Kalimantan. So it is representative of the individual cultures of those regions, as well as the theme for the Easter 2024 here at the cathedral is about solidarity for a common shared prosperity. So it's all in line with the goals of like the government going into the move of the capital, but also in the spirit of Easter, which is the spirit of rebirth and renewal. Back to you.
All right, thank you, Arya, for that report. That was Arya Siddhartha and Ferry Ahmad live from the Catholic Church Cathedral here in Jakarta. We're moving on to the next story. More than 30 students from Haluoleo University in Kendari, Southeast Sulawesi, became victims of human trafficking operation pretending to offer an internship opportunities in Germany. The students who became human trafficking victims came from various faculties, including engineering, sociopolitics, economics, business, and culture. They were sent to Germany after Haluoleo University signed a deal with Sinar Harapan Bangsa, or SHB company. Haluoleo University Rector Muhammad Zahrum Firihu said that the students did not communicate with the university after they realized they were victims of a human trafficking operation in Germany. They reported to the Indonesian embassy in Berlin instead. Afterwards, the university made attempts to communicate with the students and asked to return home. Meanwhile, Coordinating Minister for Security and Political Affairs Hadi Cahyanto has formed a special team to look into the case. We sent thousands of Indonesian students to Germany for internship. A total of 1,900 students fell victims to the scam, including 30 from the Haluoleo University. Authorities are now set to summon numbers of instances to discuss the case.
Kami juga kaget setelah ada berita itu bahwa apa ada masuk lapor kemudian diteliti oleh Baris Krim dan lain sebagainya. Itu kami baru tahu barunya setelah itu. Karena apa? Kami yakin bahwa itu karena di dalam perjanjian kita dan diskusi dan sosialisasi itu adalah sama.
Ya. Sejauh ini berarti universitas merasa tertipu juga berarti.
Ya, bisa mungkin setelah terlihat seperti itu bisa saja seperti itu. Makanya yang apa yang paling penting juga dan mahasiswa itu nanti setelah itu baru melapor ke BRI, tidak melapor ke kami gitu. Harusnya kan melapor ke universitas. Tapi oke lah, setelah semua itu jadi, kemudian setelah mendengar itu kami kontak mahasiswa kita dan kita suruh pulang dan sekarang mereka semua suruh pulang.
Jumlahnya berapa, Bro? Ada
30 kalau nggak salah 30-an.
PPPO ya, ada 32 universitas yang mahasiswanya dikirim ke Jerman. Namun kami juga akan memanggil ya pelaksanaan koordinasi yang pertama dengan Dikti, yang kedua dengan Polri, yang ketiga dengan Kementerian Luar Negeri untuk mengidentifikasi bagaimana proses pengiriman tersebut. Sehingga dari langkah-langkah itu nanti kami bisa menentukan yang terbaik apa untuk kita bisa menyelamatkan para mahasiswa itu. Kurang lebih ada 1.900 mahasiswa.
The People Representatives Council has ratified a draft for the Jakarta Special Region into law. The bill includes points for the Jakarta agglomeration area as well as several for the Jakarta regional election.
The House of Representatives or DPR has approved the Special Capital Region of Jakarta or DKJ bill in the 14th plenary meeting to be passed into law. This took place at the Parliament Complex in Senayan, Jakarta on Thursday. The bill ratification process was led by House Speaker Puan Maharani.
Selanjutnya, kami menanyakan sekali lagi kepada seluruh anggota Dewan, apakah rancangan undang-undang tentang daerah khusus Jakarta dapat disetujui untuk disahkan menjadi undang-undang? Setuju? Terima kasih.
The bill includes 12 chapters, which generally covers 7 main points. The first one is linked with the Greater Jakarta Agglomeration Area, which also includes Cianjur Regency. Second is connected with change of rules for mechanism of the Jakarta regional election. Third, the allocation of additional funding reaching at least 5% for sub-districts. This stems from the provincial government's budget and will distribute in accordance with workload and administrative area to resolve social problems. Fourth is granting 15 special authorities to Jakarta administration. This includes public works and special education as well as health and culture. Fifth is the preference of cultural goals for the advancement of the Betawi culture involving Betawi cultural institutions. Sixth is adjustment related to income, which originated from a certain license fee on space utilization activities that determine rates are in line with regulations. The last one is concerned with additional land provisions. The bill is aimed to maintain and stimulate economic activities in Jakarta, as well as displaying the government's commitment to make Jakarta a world-class city.
Pemerintah dan DPR RI memiliki visi yang sama untuk Jakarta, bahwa pasca tidak menjadi ibu kota negara, harus tetap dilekatkan status kekhususan, sehingga bisa mengakselerasi pertumbuhan perekonomian dan akan berdampak pada meningkatkan kontribusi terhadap produk domestik regional bruto Indonesia.
Following the approval of the DKJ bill by the House of Representatives, a presidential decree will be issued before the capital city can be officially moved from Jakarta to IKN or Nusantara. Maudy Kalisha, Lutfi Evan for See Today.
The number of dengue fever patients in Pati Regency, Central Java is on the rise this year. From January until March, there have been 221 patients treated at the local hospital, and one of them has died. At the moment, Suwondo Regional Hospital in Pati, Central Java is accommodating a number of dengue fever patients. Most of them are children. The hospital plans to add more rooms to specially treat dengue fever patients. In addition to treatment, the hospital also educates the patient family to apply the 3M movement, that is draining, covering, and recycling, to reduce the attack of Aedes aegypti mosquito.
Jadi untuk tahun ini dibanding tahun kemarin itu ada peningkatan yang signifikan. Jadi sampai hari ini sekarang ini sudah mencapai 221 kasus yang dirawat di Suwondo mulai Januari. Lah yang dulu tuh nggak sampai segitu setahun. Ini sudah mencapai 221 kasus yang setiap bulannya itu meningkat.
Authorities at Indonesia's new capital city, or IKN, recently set up an affordable bazaar at Sepaku with the aim of helping the public ahead of the Eid al-Fitri. Sepaku itself is an area which is set to become part of IKN in the future. The bazaar offered rice in affordable prices.
Nusantara, or IKN authorities, a women's group, Jenggala, the state logistics agency of Bulog, as well as 6th Regional Military Command, Mulawarman, visited Sepaku in North Najampaseh Regency to set up an affordable bazaar. The event took place at Bukit Raya Village Square on Saturday. The program is meant to help those with medium to low income by offering affordable commodities such as rice, sugar, and cooking oil below average market price. It was done to mark the Ramadan Holy Month and Eid al-Fitr. It greatly benefited the public as commodity prices tend to soar during the Holy Month.
Nah, kemudian bagi kita sendiri tentu momen ini pasti ditunggu oleh masyarakat ya, dalam kondisi khususnya harga beras ya. Khususnya harga beras yang cukup naik, kemudian perempuan Jenggala bersama dengan Bulog dan rekan-rekan yang lain hadir untuk memberikan sembako yang lebih murah.
The Affordable Commodities Bazaar offers 700 packages at below 80,000 rupees each. They include 5 kilograms of rice, as well as 1 kilogram of sugar and cooking oil. See today contributor reporting from North Najampaseh, East Kalimantan.
We are set for a quick break, and Satya Pramesi will return with a recap from the world of sports.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on City Day Business.
Indonesian Foreign Affairs Minister Retno Marsudi addressed the UN Security Council during an open debate in New York.
Ini adalah open debate Dewan Keamanan PBB ketiga mengenai Gaza dalam 3 bulan terakhir, dan Indonesia hadir di ketiganya.
Kenapa sih dia selalu mau eksis kalau aku syuting?
Ijo sama yang merah ini tuh rumah pribumi. Jadi aku taruh di dalam, makanya rasanya lebih welcome gitu. Modern banget. Ini tuh sempit banget kalau ceilingnya pendek. Menurut aku ya, kita belum ngerasa memiliki kalau belum ada sejarahnya.
Welcome back to the Scene Morning Show, everybody. It's time for our penultimate segment of the morning. Yes, indeed, it is sports. Beginning with EPL, where Brentford defied the odds and held Manchester United 1-1 in the 30th week of the English Premier League at the G-Tech Community Stadium on Saturday. Home team Brentford played aggressively in the match with 31 shots, 5 of which were on target. On the other hand, the Red Devils managed only 11 shots with 5 on target, while also having a 53% ball possession. Despite this, Mason Mount only managed to score the opening goal for the Reds 6 minutes into injury time. Although the match looked set to conclude in Manchester United's favors, the Bees equalized through Christopher Ajer 3 minutes after. This draw means that the Red Devils are stuck in 6th place with 48 points, while Brentford occupies 15th place with 27 points. Meanwhile, from the States, from the WNBA, Brittany Griner has returned to Phoenix Mercury, which is the only WNBA team she has ever played for, with the league announcing her signing on X on Friday night. Now, Phoenix selected Griner at the number one overall pick in the 2013 WNBA draft, following a stellar collegiate career at Baylor. The 6'8" center averages 17.7 points, 7.5 rebounds, and 2.7 blocks per game. She averaged 17.5 points and 6.3 rebounds per game last season after she was absent in 2022 as she was detained in Russia. She has returned to the U.S. as part of a high-profile prisoner swap and helped lead Phoenix Mercury to win at the 2014 WNBA Championship after winning 2 gold medals in the Olympics. She is also a 9-time All-Star, 8-time block leader, 2-time Defensive Player of the Year, and 3-time All-League First Team member. And moving on to the NBA now, Dante Exum hit the winning three-pointer with 27.5 seconds to go, while Kyrie Irving had 30 points, and the Dallas Mavericks beat the Sacramento Kings 107-103 on Friday night for their 6th straight win. Dallas, which has won 10 of its last 11 games, moves 2 games ahead of the Kings for the 6th spot in the Western Conference that would avoid the play-in tournament. Sacramento remains in the 8th spot in the West, while Exum's wide-open shot, set up by P.J. Washington, made it 106-103 and capped a second-half comeback for the Mavericks. 14 of Irving's 30 points came in the fourth quarter, and Luka Doncic, added 26 for Dallas. Harrison Barnes missed a potential game-tying three-point attempt and then committed a backcourt violation after the Kings got the offensive rebound.
They trap him at midcourt, Washington.
To tennis now, and Grigor Dimitrov followed his ruthless upset of Carlos Alcaraz with another brilliant display to beat Alexander Zverev at the Miami Open semifinals. With his 6-4, 6-7, 6-4 victory, the Bulgarian advanced to his 3rd ATP Masters 1000 and his 1st in Miami. The result also moved Dimitrov up to number 9 in the ATP rankings, securing his return to the top 10 for the first time since November 2018. Jannik Sinner awaits in Sunday's final after his 6-1, 6-2 victory against Medvedev on Friday. All right, that concludes the final sports segment of the morning. We are set for another break, and when we return, current updates and entertainment news just for you. Stay tuned.
China
has been racing against time for rescue and disaster relief work after a landslide on Monday struck a mountainous village in southwest China's Yunnan province.
Kenapa sih dia selalu mau eksis kalau aku syuting? Ijo sama yang merah ini tuh rumah pribumi. Jadi aku taruh di dalam, makanya rasanya lebih welcome gitu. Modern banget. Dia tuh sempit banget kalau ceilingnya pendek. Menurut aku ya, kita belum ngerasa memiliki kalau belum ada sejarahnya.
Inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world. Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you just stay tuned because you don't miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories, only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Kabinjai. Mau migrasi?
Cakep!
Anjay, aku di pot sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik ya.
Aduh ya Allah! Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain!
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga. Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Welcome back to the final segment of our C Morning Show. Before we proceed to our daily dose of entertainment, we have some current updates. A regional military command's ammunition warehouse at Tiang Sana Village in Bogor, West Java, which borders Bekasi, exploded at 6:30 p.m. on Saturday.
The sounds of explosions were still heard by locals well into the night.
The sounds of explosions were heard in surrounding residential areas since the 6:30 p.m. This follows an explosion at a regional military command's ammunition warehouse in Tiang Sana Village, Bogor Regency, West Java, which borders with Bekasi. Military Regional Commander Major General Muhammad Hassan said that there were no casualties in the incident. He added that the warehouse contained 160,000 types of explosives.
Gudang munisi nomor 6 itu berisi munisi-munisi yang sudah kadaluarsa dan pengembalian dari berbagai satuan yang dilayani oleh Kodam Jaya di seluruh wilayah Jakarta ini dan berkisar sekitar ada 160.000 jenis munisi maupun bahan peledak yang ada di gudang itu. Dan sampai dengan saat ini, kami sudah mengecek seluruh lokasi di perimeter kita, satu pulau ke depan, ke arah pemukiman, tidak ada korban jiwa. Itu kami tegaskan, tidak ada korban jiwa. Walaupun saat ini memang kami tidak bisa masuk langsung ke lokasi karena masih ada kerawanan, ledak-ledak kecil. Tapi dapat kami pastikan bahwa sistem pengudangan di Kodam Jaya ini, di gudang ini, sudah sangat aman. Karena lokasinya berada di bunker dan di atasnya ada tanggul-tanggul yang mengamankan kalau ada ledakan ke samping. Tapi kemudian ke atas mungkin bisa menyebar sampai ke beberapa tempat. Tapi kami pastikan bahwa prosedur maupun sistem pengamanan di gudang ini sudah singkat rupa, sehingga kalau ada ledakan seperti ini, diperkirakan akan aman.
There were reports of ammunition and magazines straying to residential areas prior to the blast. This prompted the regional military command to urge locals if they were affected by incident.
Walaupun mungkin tadi ada berita di media dan lain-lain, ada pelongsong yang sampai ke perumahan, itu memang ledakan yang mungkin horizontal kita ke atas dan sampai di satu tempat. Dan kami sudah menghimbau warga-warga di sekitar wilayah yang sana ini, 1-2 tahun ke depan, ke wilayah-wilayah yang berpemukiman penduduk, untuk mengecek apabila ada hal-hal yang mungkin terdampak dari ledakan.
Meanwhile, police lines were set up at Kota Wisata Residential Area in Cibubur, Bogor, which was affected by the blast. This follows the discovery of the mortar-like projectile, which locals suspected might have come from the blast at the ammunition warehouse. The object was found by locals not far from the scene of the explosion. It has since been secured by the military alongside several other objects. C2D contributor reporting from Bogor, West Java.
Acting West Java Governor Bey Mahmudin recently assessed the condition of those who sought shelters after a munition warehouse exploded in Bogor, West Java.
They have been requested to remain at the shelter for their own safety.
Ada 85 kakak yang di untuk sementara di tempatnya kepala desa dan 50 kakak di tempat masjid Bait Darussalam di dalam kota wisata. Dan karena ini bulan Ramadan, Pak Bupati juga menyiapkan dapur umum, tapi dapur umum sifatnya karena untuk sahur nanti, jadi disiapkan juga. Pada intinya kondisi sudah terkendali.
Dan direncanakan dievakuasi berapa lama, Pak, para warga ini yang diungsikan?
Ini juga Pak Pangdam Jaya sudah koordinasi dengan Pemprov DKI untuk pemadaman, jadi akan dikirimkan mobil pemadam kebakaran yang, karena kan di Jakarta ada mobil pemadam kebakaran yang bisa menembakkan air dari jarak jauh, nah itu akan segera datang 3 armada.
Pak, sejauh ini ada keluhan mungkin, Pak, dari warga terkait dengan peristiwa tersebut?
Tidak, mereka kondusif dan memahami bahwa mereka sebaiknya di tempat yang aman dulu, jadi tidak ada penolakan, tidak ada resistensi. Mereka sangat kondusif dan Pak Bupati juga.
Apakah ada kerusakan dari rumah warga yang terdampak?
Ini sedang didata oleh baik dari Kodam Jaya maupun dari BPBD. Pada intinya kami akan mengganti kalau ada kerusakan. Jadi masyarakat tidak perlu khawatir kalau ada kerusakan.
The Indonesian entertainment industry mourned the passing of the famed presenter Hilbram Dunar, who passed away at EMC Hospital Tangerang on early Sunday. He was 48 years old.
News of his passing was first announced by his wife, Denny Luciana, on Instagram. Aside from being a radio broadcaster, many also remember Hilbram as a motivator and TV presenter, who often hosted quiz shows and sports programs in the 2000s.
He was born on October the 30th, 1975, and published several books such as Plastic Heaven, My Public Speaking, and Cinta Itu Motivasi. From us at C3, we'd like to say farewell, Hilbram Dunar.
All right, and we still have some entertainment updates for you. The next story is from the Queen Bee, as she finally dropped her most awaited album, Cowboy Carter. It marks her 8th studio album in her illustrious music career.
After weeks of waiting with bated breath, Beyoncé's new album has finally arrived. The Houston-born superstar's 8th album is billed as multi-genre nod to America country culture. It came with chorus of praise from traditional country and country crossover artists, including several features on the album.
The album is filled with guest appearances from Dolly Parton to Post Malone and Miley Cyrus, amongst others. Prior to the official album drop, Beyoncé confirmed that the project would include a cover of Parton's Jolene. And the 78-year-old music icon quickly put her stamp of approval on it. The Cowboy Carter consists of 27 tracks and is available on all digital music platforms. Alrighty, everybody, that's just now 9:00:32 in the AM. That does it for today's episode of the C Morning Show on C Today. Thank you so much for tuning in with us. I hope you enjoyed it as much as we enjoyed delivering it to you. And be sure to also follow our social media through Instagram, X, and YouTube channel. Our handle, of course, is at C Today News.
Yes, and C Today can now be enjoyed in Australia on Foxtel's OTT platform, Flash app, or in Macau Cable TV channel 84. Or if you are in the Philippines, you can also watch the Converge Vision channel 58 and in Singtel Singapore channel 15.
And for Telkom users or any provider, you can also watch C Today News, of course, on Maxstream apps or Telkom user at My Telkom Sales app. Don't forget to also tune in again tomorrow, same time, same channel. And be sure to also catch our afternoon show, the Ramadan airtime, every day at 2:30 p.m. I'm Indra Marpaung.
My name is Shafira.
And I'm Sati Permesi. Happy Sunday, everyone.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Kadang
sering sih
pernah tapi nggak sering.
Yeah, so fortunately I never had a migraine.
Kalau aku sih biasanya paling istirahat, banyak minum air putih, terus dikompres.
Minum obat sih biasanya.
Paling istirahat yang cukup sih, pola makannya diatur gitu.
Kecapean biasanya.
Paling kecapean kerja sih atau kurang tidur aja. Iya, biasanya sih kena hujan langsung agak migrain gitu kepalanya.
Kalau aku sih penyebabnya banyak beraktivitas, kecapean, kurang tidur, kurang istirahat juga, kurang banyak minum air putih terutama.
That I don't know. I'm not a doctor, so that I cannot answer.
Many people have experienced one-sided dizziness, or so-called migraine. Have you ever got it? Annoying, right? It can be even very painful. Migraine comes from the Latin hemicrania, which means pain in the half of the head. The symptoms is a sharp pain in the partial area of your head. At first, it appears around the eyes probably, temples, or at the base of the eyebrow. Then spread to the half of the head. How it can be bothering? Serious migraine, when it attacks, can make your nose and eyes become watery, like you're having a cold.
The eyeball feels it's about to be popped out. It's very difficult to even close your eyes. Extreme nausea. In short, migraines can be very annoying and excruciating. How's it? Does anybody feel the same? Relax. In this episode, we will discuss food and drink consumption that can prevent migraine. Want to know more? Follow me, Eric Carlebang, and Secret for a Healthy. Migraine can come all of the sudden. It can also come with the typical symptoms. In a severe version, migraine can make a person feel nauseous and even vomit. When it becomes serious, it makes it even difficult to put words together. It's a form of impaired brain function. There is no definitive cause of migraine yet. There is still a lot of disagreement among experts about the causes of this problem. But there is one significant thing that can be considered as a trigger. Basically, in what we're eating. Why is it significant? Because it is proven when diet is improved, a lot of migraine sufferers stop having attacks as their health improves. Indeed, each individual has a unique tendency, especially for food problems and migraines. Some people can react in certain food, trigger migraines, while others don't. So is vice versa. Fat is often prioritized as a trigger for migraines, especially fats that are known to have a bad effect on the body. In scientific language, many fats are damaged due to exposure of oxidation, due to long processing in high temperatures. Also, animal fat, which is used in excess in cooking, beef, mutton, deep-fried chicken, full-fat milk, slow-cooked coconut milk, especially with animal protein. This automatically also includes foods made from animal innards or offals, such as liver, intestine, lung, and others. Next, food that's high in cholesterol, such as egg, ocean fish, beef, goat, and chicken. The use of margarine and butter as a substitute for oil, including when used in making cake, biscuit, various pastries, also prone to trigger migraines for some people. Aside from food, alcohol drinks, soda drinks, also trigger a lot of migraines. Even everyday drink, such as milk, can cause a chain reaction in the digestive system, which leads, again, to migraine attacks. The funny thing is, drinks that are often associated with relaxation, such as coffee and tea, can also trigger migraine.
Healthy living is so simple that it's easy to do and the cost is also affordable. It all depends on the commitment and how to make a healthy living as part of daily discipline. This migraine problem for sure includes in that part. In general, there is one big issue in everyone's health problem. Waiting to be sick first, then trying to cure. Because the concept of a healthy life is far from that. We try to prevent by taking care of our life, by trying to change from the wrong diet to the right one. Let's learn some types of ingredients and culinary menus in everyday life that can be used as a temporary solution when migraine strikes. First one is ginger and avocado as a combo.
Ginger contains antioxidant and anti-inflammatory properties that have the potential to help ease the headache. A study of 100 people found consuming ginger is effective for relieving headache, including migraines. Not only relieves headache, drinking ginger infusion also helps reduce the accompanying symptoms of migraines, such as nausea or even vomiting.
So we're here at this beautiful kitchen. Let's make the drink. This one has been known for generations in Indonesian culinary culture, which can be used to deal with migraines. Wedang jahe. Let's see the ingredients one by one. First, cinnamon has been known so well. The fragrance, again, been used by people all over the world.
And on the other hand, it's also known to have a stimulant effect on our body system, on our, especially on our digestive system and our body immune system as well. Might as well using it. Lemongrass, it's been using as well for the fragrance. Usually we whack with knife or anything, and we can smell. It's so typical, the smell. Ginger, this will make your blood vessels a bit dilated. So it helps you deal with migraines or any kind of condition where you need blood to flow uninterruptedly. Lime, we're using the lime zest for fragrance. But if you like tang sensation, you can also use the juice to blend the taste. And honey, this is for sure for your sweet tooth, making sweeter drinks, especially for wedang jahe. It helps you a lot in drinking, but you have to be very careful in using this honey. Make sure you choose the good quality one, and then on the other hand, not too much because it might get you blood sugar spike. And this is all. Let's make it. Turn off your stove, give like 300 milliliters of water. And then there you go. Put all of the ingredients inside. 2 inches of ginger. Gives a whack. And also the lemongrass. Give a good smack, whack. Cut the rest so it would fit into the pot nicely. Wait till it boils. If you can find a lid, so it will speed up the process. For the aroma, you can add lime zest. This will relax you even more. It's good. Soothing. To those of you who got sweet tooth, this may be not enough. So, using honey will help you adjust yourself, your taste well to the drink. But if it's not enough, and I'm suggesting very, very careful in using it, let's try using something else. You can use this brown rice, or Indonesian call it gula merah. Local Indonesian love this so much. They say it's better than regular sugar, but sugar is sugar. You have to be very careful in using this. It will spike your blood sugar in a way if it used too much. So, well, yes, it's more natural, but to use this, I'm suggesting you to use limited size, very, very limited. You can cut it, you can just like give a pinch of it, but I'd rather using something else in this. I'm sticking with honey. So for 300 milliliters, for a good quality honey, I'm using, I guess, around 1.5 tablespoon. Wait for it for a while. Let everything blend in more. Check it out. Here it is, wedang jahe, ready to serve. It's a better way to drink this with some sort of a treatment by taking a moment to inhale the fragrance before you sip, because the aroma fragrance will help you be calmer in dealing with disease like migraine. Drink slowly, sip by sip, let your saliva touch with the drink before we swallow. Drink natural ginger infusion like this, or we call it wedang jahe, in some cases can prevent or at least relieve migraine attacks from getting worse. Next, we will make a very tasty and useful menu to relieve migraines. Therefore, stay in secret for a healthy life for the next menu. By cutting it into pieces, smaller pieces, and then maybe softening a little bit. You need to get rid of this big fiber in the center.
Berangkat aja dulu, kerjakan apa yang ada di depan kalian. Setidaknya kalian hari ini walaupun tidak mendapatkan uang, tapi kalian mendapatkan kesempatan.
Walaupun di awal-awal itu banyak sekali rintangan dan tantangan.
Kalian berproses aja dulu, jalan aja dulu. Kalau udah waktunya kalian untuk dapetin uang, uang akan datang nyamperin kalian. Hal yang paling sangat utama untuk mengawali bisnis, ridho dan restu orang tua. Itu hal dan modal paling besar dalam mengawali usaha.
Group of volunteers operating in the south of the city has united to assist displaced children in a refugee camp in Rafah in overcoming the trauma of war. The volunteers come from diverse professional backgrounds and share expertise in working with young people.
Figur publik kok kere?
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobang gosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Still with me, Erika Lebang, in the secret for a healthy life. Earlier, we've made a delicious menu that is useful for relieving migraines. That was wedang jahe. Next, we will make an avocado-based menu. Avocado is one ingredient, even though it's actually a fruit, but because it contains low fructose or fruit sugar, it's considered to be a vegetable. With this fact, you can eat avocado freely. Different treatment from eating like regular fruit. This is the avocado smoothies recipes that I usually make in my daily life. Before I got here in this beautiful kitchen, I bought myself fresh avocado. And this is the main star in making avocado smoothies. Avocado, a nice vegetable slash fruit. Dealing with problems like migraine. It contains minerals like calcium, magnesium that has a chain reaction, and a derivative result is give you calmer, soothing, and serene sensation, which is very useful in dealing with migraines. Next, we're giving you Indonesian called the selasih. It's more like a basil seed. It will expand when it touches the water or any liquid like this. So we are soaking this selasih in water for like at least 10 to 15 minutes or more. This, again, contains a lot of minerals. If you chew it well, it gives you a lot of minerals. But it also helps you expanding your intestine to its fullest form, so it's easier for digestive system to actually move your food from one point to another point. And again, honey. As a sweet tooth to easily absorb or eat or drink something, sometimes you need sweeter taste than regular, but which it's not a really good habit, but I suggest you using some sort of a substance like honey. Good quality honey will help you deal with that. Use a little, as little as you can as well, because if it's too much, your blood sugar will go wild. Will spike your blood sugar in a that could be harmful for your health. Avocado. Split this in two. Get rid of the seed. And we start scraping what's inside. Scraping the meat. Be careful not to touch the skin, otherwise you got bitter taste. We add 300 milliliters of water. I got the consistency that I want, but one thing to add here is that the speed from the blade creates heat, which heat, it lessens the effectiveness of the enzyme from fresh avocado that has inside. But for that, I have a solution. This ice cube will lessen the heat, so the heat while not tampering the enzyme that contained inside the fresh avocado. Now this is the perfect consistency that I want to make it as a smoothie.
Now put it in the glass.
You got it here, a nice consistency, smooth enough to be called smoothies. And we add on another benefit coming from full teaspoon of, I guess I'm gonna take 2 or 3 teaspoons of basil seeds, Selassie. Personally, this is already a great drink. But to those of you who love sweet, smoothies will probably need more effect by adding some honey. I'm using probably around 1/2 teaspoon of honey. Wedang jahe and avocado smoothies are my 2 reliable menus against migraine, but this should not be considered as a medicine. Remember that. This is part of healthcare. The main action is in your daily discipline. Okay, for the next menu, we'll make a quite unique menu in Indonesia, a dessert. The name is es tape kacang merah, or you can call it sweet cassava with red beans or kidney beans. Well, let's see how to make es tape kacang merah. This is sweet cassava, or in Indonesian call it tape. It based as a regular cassava being fermented for days, and it turned out to be sweet, soft substance like this. Many Indonesians love this. Basically, it's not just good, especially if you're a sweet tooth person, but in other way, research found out that this fermented cassava also good for your digestive system because it becomes like a prebiotic. Prebiotic means it's a good food substance for the good bacteria in your digestive system as well. So if you're giving a good food for them, they live okay, then your health is going to be a top notch. The research find out that many of the migrant sufferers had also bad digestive system. So in a way to say that cassava, sweet cassava, can be an answer to them, if you put it in the right way, could be a good reason for that. And now cinnamon, it's also good for calming and give a nice soothing sensation, which is again very useful when you're having migraine. Red bean, this, if cooked properly, will be a very good match, very good partner with the sweet cassava, because this is sweet, this is savory, and both are soft, which they're like match made in heaven. Coconut milk, or in Indonesian call it santan, it gives you savory but yet supporting the sweet sensation of a dessert. So it's nice. And especially when it's fresh like this, it's also having a menu of like tons of good substance, which is very good for your health. Brown sugar. This is the better version of a regular sugar because it's more natural, but still, don't use it too much. Still, sugar is sugar. It's gonna give you a blood sugar spike. So be very careful in using this. Pandan leaves. The aroma is very good. It also gives you the oil itself creates, when it comes to heat, gives you some sort of a soothing sensation. Again, helps you when you're dealing with migraines. And this is it. Those are the bad boys that are going to help me making the es tape kacang merah. Okay, first I just boiled the kacang merah, the red beans, the kidney beans. Before you boil it, before you're using it, it's much better if you soak this in water like 24 hours before, so it's easier to cook. I already boiled this, and then it's time for me to add the cinnamon, the Thai, the nut, down pandan leaves. Off you go, boil it all. While we're waiting for the red bean to be even softer, we can process this sweet cassava by cutting it into pieces, smaller pieces, and then maybe softening a little bit. We need to get rid of this big fiber in the center and then cut it into smaller pieces. There you go. Chopped cassava. I think it's soft enough. Yeah, so we break apart. It's a sign that it's already soft enough to make as a part of our estape cacang merah. Might as well use the liquid as well. Drizzle it with coconut milk. Drizzle it on top. The eyes, the main star of the dish. Cool. Truly a dessert now.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Indonesian Foreign Affairs Minister Retno Marsudi addressed the UN Security Council during an open debate in New York.
Ini adalah open debate Dewan Keamanan PBB ketiga mengenai Gaza dalam tiga bulan terakhir dan Indonesia hadir di ketiganya.
Bringing you the latest, interesting and inspiring news from Indonesia, Southeast Asia and around the world.
Our three-hour news show will air early during the month of Ramadan every day at 2:30 p.m.
And be sure you to stay tuned because you don't want to miss all the Ramadan stories from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the world in our special segment, See the Ramadan Stories, only on
the three-hour news show on See Today.
Still with me at Secret for a Healthy Life. Let's try this one. Just remember something. I still have selasi. I still have the seeds of basil. Wait. It's gonna be a nice compliment to this one. Sweet selasi, sweet basil seeds. Such a perfect dessert. Look at how amazing it looks. It's really, really appetizing. And the smell, so sweet. It's like heaven. The smell of tape, sweet cassava, and red beans is so refreshing. And how does it taste? Let's check it out. Refreshing. Softness of the red bean, sweetness of the cassava, savory and fresh taste from the coconut milk, nice texture out of the basil seeds, match made in heaven. The eyes, I'm completely forgetting about it. The eyes, the main star of the dish. Crushed ice, you can put it in the fridge actually, but let's make it instant. Cool, truly a dessert now. To my grain, try to get rid of any food that are suspected of triggering this problem for like 1 or 2 months. If the migraine doesn't appear anymore, most likely those food we avoid is the cause of the migraine. On the other hand, we must also understand what is the basic of human body. from the digestive point of view. As usual, judging from the teeth, organs, and the work of the digestive system, we know that the basic of human diet is fresh food, vegetables, and whole grains. Let's have a look at them and focus there. Stay with me on another episode of Secret for a Healthy Life with me, Eric Carlebang. See ya.
Happy people, having balanced life is a dream of many people. Balance in physical and mental. How nice it is to live and fulfill needs that are in harmony with those two things. And wellness is an art to keep the balance of life. Then, how do we get balanced life? There are so many ways to be picked by people to reach the balance of life. One of them is yoga. Do you like to practice yoga? Me, myself, has never really learned about it. So today, I will meet a yoga instructor to get to know more about yoga. In Wellness Stories, we will share, learn, and discover how to achieve and maintain balance in life, in everyday life. I'm Ju, I will be with you for the next 30 minutes.
Ya Bu, tapi aku pemula banget ya, jadi nggak pernah yoga. Jangan yang susah-susah.
Oh iya, bisa, gampang bisa.
Bisa ya Bu. Ya. Sekarang ngapain ya dulu nih?
Yuk kita duduk dulu.
Duduk.
As a beginner, I want my body can adapt first with yoga movement. If this is the first time you learn about yoga too, let's follow the instruction together.
Sebelum kita mulai latihan, kita pegangan dulu supaya nggak terkejut badannya karena belum pernah yoga ya.
Kaku banget kayaknya badannya.
Ya kita duduk. Ini namanya duduk vajrasana.
Oh gitu caranya.
Ini duduk, duduk di atas tumit ya, pastikan tulang duduknya ada di atas tumit. Kemudian dari sini kita bawa ke arah child pose dulu, buka kedua lututnya selebar pinggul, terus tarik ke arah depan. Kayak gini, tarik. Tarik ke arah depan, panjangkan tulang punggungnya dulu, bawa peregangannya, rasakan tulang punggungnya memanjang. Kemudian tarik bawah lututnya sedikit ke arah sisi luar. Rasakan peregangan di area tulang punggung, tarik nafas, buang nafasnya. Kemudian pandangannya, angkat kepalanya, pandang lihat ke arah tangan. Kemudian angkat tubuhnya ke arah atas.
And it's just the beginning. Keeping the body in a balanced state is not an easy thing. How about maintaining the balance in life? Kerasa loh Bu ya, peregangannya. Terus habis ini,
kembali ke arah duduk, satukan telapak tangannya seperti ini, terus tarik ke arah depan. Angkat tangannya ke arah atas, bahunya menjauh dari telinga, tarik nafas, buang nafas, kemudian bawa ke arah samping sebelah kanan, tarik nafas, buang nafas, bawa ke arah tengah, kemudian bawa ke arah sisi sebelah kiri,
kembali ke arah tengah, inhale, kemudian exhale, twist ke arah sisi sebelah kanan, bawa twist ke arah sisi sebelah kanan, tangannya dibawa turun. Angkat lagi tangan ke arah atas, tarik nafas, kemudian buang nafas, twist bawa ke arah sisi sebelah kiri. Nafas, kemudian angkat tangan ke arah atas, inhale, kemudian exhale, bawa turun tangannya ke arah bawah.
It sounds so easy, but the fact is not that easy for beginner. So many times, I find it difficult to maintain a balanced body position. But don't worry, with regular exercises, we will get used to do yoga correctly and well. Regularly practicing yoga will help to strengthen our body and also can make our mind more calm and help to control anger.
Di yoga kita bisa belajar bernafas untuk menekan emosi kita. Caranya bagaimana, ada nafas di yoga yang bisa kita menghandle setiap kita sedang alut gitu. Tuh, di situ. Jadi dengan bernafas kita bisa melatih emosi kita.
Yoga connects the posture and breath with meditation. Yoga is a tradition that originated in India thousands of years ago and is rooted in teaching of Hindu philosophy. Back in its home, yoga becomes a ritual to free yourself from sadness and find the peace of mind, to control our five senses and the body as a whole. Cultivating the breath and focusing is the key to get balance in yoga practice. Yoga unites the body with the mind and heart, bringing us to positive energy and achieve the balance. Now, yoga becomes one of the most popular exercises and likes by urban modern society. Yoga movements have also been developed, like this swing yoga.
Saya kena skoliosis. Skoliosis lumbar itu pernah di MRI. Itu setelah terapi di rumah sakit, disarankan untuk renang sama yoga. Cuma saya lebih tertarik sama yoga.
Novi joined yoga for the first time in 2017. Since that, she is regularly doing yoga and focus in movements that can help her to fix her posture.
Yoga itu kita jadi lebih memperbaiki postur tubuh yang pasti. Saya kan memang basicnya tuh agak bongkok dari postur tubuhnya. Sekarang lebih lumayan lah tegap.
If Novi joins yoga to return her physical balance, it's different with Tita. She tried yoga for the first time in 2011. Tita feels yoga can bring her to a balanced lifestyle.
Keseimbangan hidup bisa dari mencintai diri sendiri, kemudian dari pola istirahat dan pola hidup sehat, dan dengan yoga itu mengubah lifestyle ya, menjadi hidup yang sehat. Bisa mengubah pola hidup saya yang sebelumnya mungkin tidak sehat menjadi sekarang lebih sehat, dan pola istirahat tidur menjadi jam tidur terutama itu bisa lebih konsisten dan juga bisa lebih baik dari yang sebelumnya.
Wellness living is not just about exercise and nutrition. Quality sleep and enough rest are also important in maintaining a balanced, healthy life. How is your sleep pattern lately? If you can't sleep but your physical condition is fine, maybe you have to pay attention on your psychological aspect. We will discuss about it right after this. Stay in Wellness Stories.
Thank you.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
A group of volunteers operating in the south of the city has united to assist displaced children in a refugee camp in Rafah in overcoming the trauma of war. The volunteers come from diverse professional backgrounds and share expertise in working with young people.
Their existence is now being critically endangered.
Dia memiliki ekor yang sangat panjang, lebih panjang, jauh lebih panjang daripada badannya sendiri.
Tekniknya dia keluar, dia itu bergelombol menggunakan punggung temannya untuk naik.
Sebenarnya konservasi burung hantu di sini latar belakangnya jelas asas manfaat. Jadi kita pengen melestarikan burung, melestarikan satwa, tapi juga otomatis dampaknya ke masyarakat yang khususnya sekarang kalau di sini kan petani.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Previously in Indonesia, talking about mental condition was considered taboo because most people think that an unhealthy mental condition is same as a psychiatric disorder, even though this is not always the same. This phenomenon is starting to change along with the advances in information and technology, plus a pandemic.